sick, yeah, Hey, man, what? Hey, hey, no. I be like, watch your mouth. They ain't know how far I take it, they ain't know it's my house. Everything I do is to offend. We wanna all win, gotta top 10. But I top your 10, but I top your Benz, but I top your M's, but I chop your limbs.
Yo, what's good? What's happening? We back. Brand new episode of the Black Talkers of Culture. Of course, it's your boy Chris J. Glad to be back. Got the whole squad on here. We all here.
Yo, it's Trail Sad, man. Just living life the best way possible.
What's good, it's DC.
I'm a beast. And that's Young Cam G. So we all here. We all present. Make sure you copy some merch on utweakingmedia.net. Stream all the smoke by our boy Chaz Vibe. He also got a new single out, Exit 283. Check that out as well. And make sure you pre-order Durag Season, because that is dropping in the next couple of months. So pre-order right now. It's only $5 on iTunes and any other
Smackarinos.
Any other digital platform where you can purchase music. It should be around the same price. So cop, please. So anyway, let's go ahead and get into this episode. We got a lot to talk about. Definitely a lot to talk about. We wasn't here last week, but hey, you got a Black Otaku reviews to cover what need to be covered. But what we've been reading, watching, and playing. For me, playing, I ain't played shit, honestly. Like, I don't think I cut my PlayStation on at all this week. I did go to Dave & Buster's and played some games. So I guess that sort of counts. But yeah. Now, in terms of reading One Piece, which we will say for Black Otaku reviews, and My Hero, both were really good. Well, I read the spoilers for My Hero, so really decent chapters for both. Shout out to my boy Sanji on One Piece having his moment, and yeah. What else? Oh, like I said, I read My Hero. Read Dragon Ball Super because I didn't read it last week. That was a decent chapter, and I just don't give a fuck what happens on Boruto no more. I just don't care. I don't. So that's it is what it is when it comes to that. Now for watching. So this anime season is the current. What is this spring anime season coming to an end? Starting.
I think this is the last week.
Yeah, this is legit the final week for most stuff, and then like a few stragglers that may be around next week. But mostly everything's ending this past couple of weeks. So the stuff I've been watching, so start off with Higa Hero, the show where my man's is literally holding a child hostage, without actually, pretty much. So last two episodes, because this still has one more episode, I think, as well. It's one more episode. But the last two episodes. So, last week's episode, he agreed to let her go back to her family and all that, her brother and all that, which he didn't have a problem with. It was like, hey, go ahead. They gave a backstory on the girl. Pretty much her friend was bullied because of her, whopped the band, and so, like, all of that happened. So, she goes back to the school. No, so rewind, I'm going too fast. So she goes back with her brother. The man goes with her just to meet her, just to make sure she's there, make her comfortable or whatever, because she was really pleading. So they go back to her hometown. They drive past her school. She wants to go to the school. Why in Japan do schools be open overnight? Cam, do you have an answer for that? Because I know you did visit. Why do schools be open at night?
That's more of like an exaggerated anime thing. Schools do tend to stay out late, but it's mostly due to like sports clubs, after school clubs, and stuff like that.
Okay,
so that's probably not probably, but like overnight, like how late we talking?
It was like pitch dark and it looked like there was nobody in that building.
Yeah, no, it wouldn't stay open for that late. Okay. School activities and that's it.
Okay, so. So yeah, so he takes Sayu. So Sayu wants to go to her school. What was my man's? I think it was Yoshino, whatever. She said, come with me, walk the band. So they go on the roof where her let her best friend jumped off the roof. The school puts up long fences at the top of the roof afterwards. I'm like, why was there not a long fence up there before to prevent kids from jumping off roofs?
They typically always have the long fences.
Exactly.
So, it's the origin story for the long fences.
There we go. So shout out to irresponsible adults being the theme of this show. So she pretty much has a breakdown. Dude consoles her without the bam. So then
she has a breakdown,
like a mental breakdown, because like she reliving like her seeing her friend jump off the roof.
That's your fault, stupid. Why would you go back to the roof?
So yeah, she has a mental breakdown, mental emotional breakdown. Duke gets her to calm down, so they go back in the car with her brother. Brother drops them off at her mama. They go to her mom's house. So the mom ain't shit at all. Because, like, her mom kind of played a role in making her want to run away because, like, she was blaming her for her friend dying, saying, did you push her and shit like that? And it was like, she said, you know what, fuck this, I'm gone. That was the reason why she ran away. That was, like, the final straw for her to run away. So they get in the house. Dude says, hey, Ma, I brought Sayu home. And literally the mom pulls up and slaps the shit out of her daughter, G. No work. Like, she pushes her son out the way, like, yo, get the fuck out the way, and slaps the shit out of her. And then, it was supposed to be sad.
That's a black mom, dog.
That's a black mom ass.
That's
reaction.
What a black mom is doing if you ran away and you come home. Like, you thinking that she go, oh my God, sweetie, I'm sorry.
Like, no, he was gone for 6 months. He was gone for 6 months.
About to get curb stomped, G.
So, like, she slaps, she don't say a word, she just slaps the shit out of her. And then they play the happy ass ending song. So I'm like, gee, this does not help this scene at all. So, episode ends. Next week's episode starts. Well, this week's episode starts. Pretty much, they have a sit down and explaining everything. The mom pretty much says her piece, literally says, like, hey, bitch, you shouldn't have went nowhere. You made me stress. You know, I don't know what the hell you was doing out here. Who's this nigga and shit like that. Like, the mom was just being a mom, but also kind of being a really trash ass mom. And I was just like, yo, everything about this is funny. So the brother like, hey, no, she's okay. He wasn't like that. So then Yoshino, he was like, hey, I did not fuck your daughter. I was not on that. I was just being a father-like figure pretty much. Said,
that don't
hey,
matter.
I know.
That ain't gonna hold up in court.
Literally, I know. Exactly. We know this. We know this. So I was like, he like, it wasn't like, oh, none of that. Is that all it took was, it should have been a 911 call. But he said his piece. He didn't really agree with how the mom was coming at her. He kind of said some stuff like, hey, you should, pretty much told ass, you kind of being a trash mom and you're the reason why she left.
You say what?
Should call 911 again.
You said what, nigga? I go ahead and skip. He literally has no power in that situation. Whatever he says is absolutely mute. And all she got to do is
call the police. So, and the funny thing is like they did kind of break down the battle of him because he really didn't want to say shit. Like, most of the dialogue in the beginning of the episode came from the mom and very much little from Sayu. So she was like, so he just said, okay, can I just speak? And she kind of let him talk. Roasted that nigga, whatever. He said something, and then she just had to break down herself, saying, she literally just screamed, what the hell, for no reason, like 5 minutes. And it just cut away. Then it came back. They said, all right, Sayu's going to stay there without the bam. Then she told him, go back to Japan. At first, I'm thinking, you're like, oh, yo, she about to send this nigga to jail, but I was like, nah, I guess not. But so the episode ends like that. So it has one more episode. I don't know what else is there to clear up. So it is what it is. So
is the manga
decent.
Over?
The manga, yeah, the manga's over. Yeah, it was a light novel. So you know how.
Oh, light novel. Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, so it's about next week's episode is the final episode. Megalo Boxing was decent, really decent. We're pretty much going to get the final episode tomorrow, so shout out to that.
They also played the full version of the ending, so I got to search that shit up.
We need the name of that song.
That song, that bro. I don't know if that's because I did hear some stuff about that in this song. I don't know if that's a Japanese dude or like an authentic, you know, person who's speaking the language who's singing the song. I heard it's like some collaboration between like the bands or something. But if that's a Japanese dude that's singing that ending, hey, give him respect. His flowers, dog.
respect, G. What else? DV Fluorite song that ended last week. Really good episode. She pretty much saved the future, and the AIs didn't kill all humans. So that really good though. Like it was, I feel like that's one of my favorite shows of this anime season. Burning Cup Comedy was really good. It didn't give me a tournament arc, and I'm disappointed. How are you a sports anime? I don't give a fuck how many episodes you got. Give me a tournament.
But would you really want to see a tournament arc just for them to lose? Because you know they're not gonna win.
You're right. But they won the greatest practice match of all time. So they won the greatest practice match ever. Zombieland Saga season finale. This episode was freaking amazing. Lots of song singing. I was happy and I'm satisfied. That ending though is probably one of the most weirdest endings ever to set up for season 3. I'm cool with it. But I think they jumped the shark by introducing aliens into this universe. It ended with a UFO popping up at the end.
Did they explain why they're zombies yet?
Yes, they actually briefly did on last week's episode. So pretty much the little town they're from, Saga, had like a nasty typhoon which flooded the whole little town, and during the course of that they lost their house and all of that. But the guy Romero, he was at a bar with some old nigga, and pretty much that old guy has the power to resurrect zombies because he has the power of immortality. So
did they explain him?
No.
So it's a cop out then. All right.
It was literally a cop out because I was like, okay, because like it explains why, because the one, the little courtesan chick, the with the where's the kimono and shit, the one that looks like an adult.
Yeah.
She they gave her flashback, kind of explained her story, and they briefly brought him up, and I was like, why that nigga look familiar? So yeah, so it kind of ties in because I'm like, how in the hell does she play a role in all of this?
Do they explain why he only revives girls so they can become idols?
Not yet. It's like when you get to it, then something happens. Like they introduced a decent amount of plot the last 4 episodes, but it's just like it copped out in certain aspects. Either way, I'm here for the singing. Those songs were fire for the and they plan succeeded. Then aliens, a UFO popped up at the end. And I was like, where are we going next with this shit? So, but the final episode was really good. Really good. Caught up on Demon School, a room of Demon School. That's decent. My man's told one of his demon teachers he's a human and nothing bad happened to him. So, that's what's up. What else is up? Shadow House is really good. I take back what I said a few episodes ago that the shadows are niggas. I take that shit all the way back. I was incredibly wrong. I apologize. And with that being said, it's still really good. It's just the fact that the shadows are literally just humans with suit powers and taken from another poor little town and shit like that. It's weird. But still decent. Getting something I've been watching. They got hit everything. No, wait, Tokyo Revengers. There we go. It's been really good, but we just know Takemichi is an elite tier bitch, made ass nigga, who don't know how to get shit right and lucks up. With that being said, this week's episode was hilarious in the sense of just that last 5 minutes was very much needed to let me know, like, hey, can't you want to say something so bad? But the last 5 minutes was needed. Shout out to H2 Hummers, G. That's all I'm going to say. Shout out to H2 Hummers. And I'm gonna let Cam go on his rant when it's his turn. But that's it for me, though. Like, yeah, that's it for me. So,
alright, cool. So, for me, I can start off by watching first because I took it upon myself to go off of the bracket for a second because a lot of them shows are boring. But to go on to like some of the shit that I want to watch, and I was like, let me go ahead run through Mob Psycho. I heard it was a really good show. Season one was really good. Season two was fucking amazing. I will say, coming across my many of me animes, Mob Psycho is not one of them. It's nowhere near. Actually, I would say, I don't know if it hits like a top 10 list or anything, but I'll also say this. Doesn't mean it's like, again, my list is necessarily not if the show is good, but how it makes me feel emotionally, especially at the time and place I was at. I'm in like one of the best places like ever, so I really don't have no show really making me feel emotionally. But this show is probably is in my near perfect tier. Nothing's perfect, but it's definitely up there. I have no qualms with no characters, no storylines, nothing. It's very, very good. All the hype generated around it when it first came out was very, very fucking valid. There's a lot of cap from their fan from the fans, but it's valid. It definitely should get all the praise that it got when it first came out. The animation was probably the most unique I ever seen. It reminds me of like Adult Swim, Super Jail to be exact, and how the animation goes and how it's quirky. Don't take yourself seriously. A lot of people will probably, if this is like any other show, they will, you know, stop the screen and say, look at this animation and post on Twitter. But since it was Mob Psycho, it was better. And I enjoyed every step of the way. Mob, very good main character. But I would like to say this. I never want to hear Talk No Jutsu as a bad thing ever again. I didn't give a fuck about Talk No Jutsu. I don't have a problem with it. It's cool in my book. But I hate it as people will see that as a trope just because they can't pay attention to something. And this coming from me. I turned shit off when we got subtitles, dog. So, like, for me to be like, yo, it's cool if a nigga gonna talk to this guy about, you know, why the fuck he's a bad guy. You know what I'm saying? But Mob Psycho literally talked more than Naruto in that whole entire fucking show. It's hilarious because, really, in all honesty, that show, when people talked about that show, nobody talked about how he literally went to the final villain, sat there on his knees, and said, I'm going to spend time with you because nobody else had. Like, nigga, even Naruto ain't do that shit. But it is what it is. I enjoyed the show for what it is. Like I said, near perfect. Anybody get a chance to watch it. The action scenes were really, really good. The color was fucking amazing. Every fight scene popped. It was especially this one scene in the last episode in which it was one of these, because the last episode was like a crescendo of all the niggas that he saved with his words. And the last dude, one of the last people he saved came up. And he was like this dude that no one can control, like an Esper no one can control. Yeah. And he came up out of the ground, like roots and shit like that. It looked really fucking good. Enjoyed that moment. The final fight was nice. They play it back of like a fucking, I don't know if it was early in the season or like a season one episode that it actually spoiled in a theme, which was freaking crazy. In a theme of, I think, season one, there's a fucking broccoli out of absolutely nowhere. And that same broccoli was like one of the last things that helped Mob survive. Fucking hilarious. But yeah, definitely watch that show if you get a chance to. It's not that hard. I think it was like 13 episodes each season. So I got through that very quickly while I was at work. But that's that. I've been steadily watching, you know, Tokyo Revengers like everybody else. It is what it is. I don't have a opinion on that show other than, you know, that nigga ass and Mikey and Draken is cool. Nigga got shanked. That was hilarious. But other than that, I got to catch up on Megalobox. I do not like depression shit, so that's why I stopped watching that. Imagine me. I don't like waking up in the morning. Some of the things I do before I go to work, I try to watch anime. And I don't like watching depression shit. Most of that shit is depressing, especially with a nigga who literally has CTE and he's like two steps from biting his child's head off. So I was like, I'm Gucci on that. But I'll definitely catch back up and watch it. Probably tomorrow, who knows? I feel like it. But on to playing. So I've been playing a couple things. Ran through Ratchet & Clank. Love the game. If you ever get a PS5, like I said when I was reviewing it, it should be a game that you know, you cop, you get the chance. Very easy. That's my only gripe. The game is too fucking easy. Even on challenge mode, because I went through challenge mode again to level up like some weapons and shit. Basically, new game plus. Game is like easy. One, the boats make that shit easy because you can get infinite health if you want to after you find a certain amount of boats. But I didn't do that shit. I did get infinite ammo. Fuck that. But even with like you can run through with one weapon. And I remember at one point, I was going against like, I was towards the end. I was going against, it was like they threw like three bosses at you or some shit. You had to kill them all at the same time. And I remember I was just like, okay, I got these little, what's the Glove of Doom little bots up, maxed out. Let me use that. Let me use the fucking sprinkler. And let me use like two of the fucking mushroom things. I just stood there and watched those things annihilate that fucking boss. It was fun though. I enjoyed my time. I would say comparing it to like old Ratchet and Clank, that shit used to be brain. Like, I used to want to pull my fucking hair out playing those games. Like, them bitches used to be hard. Because it's a platformer. And two, like, niggas like will literally look at you and try to kill you. In this game, even getting the gold bolts was easy as fuck. Other games of Ratchet and Clank, like getting the gold bolt, you will be surprised if you get one of them holes going through a mission because you accidentally slept them. You have to look for them through like a guide or something or through a puzzle. Like in this game, there's like probably two puzzles in which you have to solve to get a bolt. Other than that, but I love the game. Hit it with the platinum because I think when I beat the game, it said I was like missing like three trophies. So I was like, I might as well run through it again. And the only trophy I was missing was like the Krager Bear ones. That was like, it was the Krager Bear ones and Repulsor and changed the radio like three times. Like, easy ass trophy. The Krager Bear one, it was easy because the game is fun. So I ran through it again. But that fucking sending shot back with that one fucking gun, that shit not my cup of tea. Just because you have to kill the enemy with its bullets. You can't kill other enemies with their bullets. You have to kill that particular enemy with that bullet. When I'm playing on challenge mode, it's like 40 fucking enemies. So it took like 6 hours. But I finally got it. Other than that, platinum it. Other than playing, you know, the like chivalry and all the shooters and stuff with my homies, I bought Far Cry 5 because that shit was like $9. This is the worst game I ever played in my whole entire life. Because other Cam was like, bro, and it's the thing, like, me and other Cam will be the only two niggas that's down to, like, play shit. So we was like, hey, you want to cop Far Cry 5? And I'm like, all right, I got you. And we down. So we both play multiplayer. When I tell you this game is so fucking ass, the only how we had so much fucking fun is because we were doing that shit, bro. I play it by myself, man. But if I was like sitting here and ain't winning no parties or nothing or distracted like I am now, I wouldn't be able to play this fucking game, bro. Like, it is so fucking bad. The way like skills unlock, you don't unlock them through like progression. You unlock them through like skill points that you get through either, you know, doing shit or you get them through like doing shit like challenges or doing shit on the map. Like, you get a magazine or something if you go through like the stash. That shit stupid because some of the skill points are shit like a weapon wheel. Like, you're getting another unlock on a weapon wheel or a fucking like a parachute. Like, you can go through that whole game without having a fucking parachute, which is hilarious when you find that shit out. But the main problem is the fucking open world. And a lot of people had a problem with the game because it was a big expanse of open world. That wasn't my gripe. I play these type of games. My gripe is that the AI in this game literally is like, okay, mind you, think of me in this game as a 16-year-old female at McDonald's. The AI is R. Kelly of how they fucking try to hawk you down, bro. I can't explain to you how bad this shit is, bro. Like, it is a bullet in the head. Like, you would hit a corner, there's 40 niggas right there, right? You're like, all right, I killed 40 niggas. Then there's a fucking plane doing an aerial raid on you. You're like, what the fuck this plane come from? All right, you took the plane out the sky. Then there's a nigga in a fucking helicopter shooting you with a minigun. It kills your fucking dog. Y'all know how much I hate when fucking dogs get killed in a video game. Mercs the dog. Can't go save the dog because you're getting fucking pelted by fucking helicopters. Helicopter, you take that down. Then there's a fucking army brigade of niggas on mounted guns, and then you ragdoll across the room because they shitted on you. This is the only thing they can do is shit on you. It is bad. None of these characters actually stick. The best thing about this game is me being able to skip dialogue because I'm not hearing none of that shit. that is a statement for me. You are a 10 out of 10 of a game. You got boring fucking dialogue, and I could press either one button. Whole circle or options. I press them two buttons, bro. I will play your game for the rest of the day, G. Another big gripe, other than that open world shit, like Far Cry 3, yeah, getting killed by a random tiger was fucking fun. Like, for like the time it was in that game, if you played 4 or the other one that came out after fucking 3, yeah, cool. This shit here, bro, it's like I get attacked by Mongols. That's fucking cool. But if an eagle sees me and don't want to attack me, everybody's on alert. So I can't talk to nobody until that fucking eagle comes out the sky. I don't know if anybody who made an Ubisoft ever tried to shoot a fucking bald eagle off the sky, but the shit's not easy. And the reason it's not easy, because of the weapons they give you. Not only is the weapon play bullshit, but it's overpriced bullshit. And what I mean by overpriced bullshit, start off the game, plethora of weapons. You look at the weapons, you be like, all right, let me do it. Say for instance, a gun costs like $2,000, $6,000, around that range. Your ass walking around with 10 smackaroos throughout the whole fucking game. This ain't no you big balling. Like, I have to go purposely search money. And then the way, because it's monetized, I get to that part later. But the way they do your ammo, you can't pick like, okay, I want handgun bullets, I want grenades, I want LMG. You gotta refill all your ammo. So me, I don't use fucking rocket launchers, but I have to fill rockets, which probably costs like $50 a fucking rocket, right? So I gotta buy all that. But if you wanna be a bitch, go to the Ubisoft store, get you some silver, and buy the same exact weapons, but they call prestige weapons. They got skins on them. So it's a very bad game. I said spend $10. I couldn't have put that on a BK chicken sandwich, honestly. I've been trying to watch my weight. But other than that, it's been chill. I ain't really been doing anything. I almost deleted Dokkan Battle. But that's one of the
did day. Delete Dokkan Battle.
Huh?
I thought y'all.
I don't spend money on that game, so I gotta delete shit. But like, I almost deleted that guy. Like that shit blew me. But I'm done. I ain't got nothing else.
Well, I'm about to move at the speed of light because I ain't do shit. But what did I do? I watched the One Piece episode that came out today. Fuck Toei, because you let Kanjuro parry this nigga Sanji. Fuck you, and then you let Kinemon get saved by Law's crew. That's some bitch ass shit. Cause Law's crew doesn't do shit. I don't even know them niggas' names, and they got like.
Are you talking about the? Was that Law's the last crew. Week's episode when they did the boat stuff? Or are you talking about?
Yeah,
the,
I mean, yeah. I'm talking about last episode too, low key, because I just remembered. But they showed it in the, you know, the recap shit at the beginning of the episode.
Denjiro, did he slice a boat in half in the manga?
Yeah, that was last week. Yeah, he did that, but you know how Oda draw were. It was like a regular slash. But in the anime, they overdid that shit. They made it seem like he was.
Yeah, because I'm saying, like,
he was cold.
Yeah. Like, they made him look cold, and I'm like, why are you making him look cold? Because that nigga doesn't equate to shit we're at now.
You know how Toei be. It's anime continuity, and then you got manga continuity.
The boat scene, that was cold. But then when I saw him slice that boat in half, I was like, you wasted money on this. Like, you could have saved. Like, nobody was like, you know what I want to see? The scene where Luffy, Law, and Kid pull up on that boat. I want to see a raw-ass scene with Denjiro slicing the boat in half. That's literally a My Hero flashback, a My Hero PowerPoint that you skip that shit and you move on. Like, I don't care about seeing this nigga slice a boat in half.
Oh, I give a fuck, though. Some Japanese niggas, like random people doing shit. But we all know that the Scabbers, they about to do some wild, like, crazy shit. If they let Denjiro do that on the ship, I'm already prepared. They're going to let Raizo do some crazy Naruto Shippuden.
I'm just waiting for that fight they got with Kaido, bro. It's going to be so much cap in that fight.
They better not throw in cap in there.
Oh, I didn't even get to the good part. So they showed Jinbei. He did like a big-ass Kamehameha wave water shooting beam thing, and he never did that shit in the manga. And if he does do it, it's like a little... Like, he stabbed the ship, but in this... In the anime episode, he like obliterated shit, and then he started throwing like energy beam water bullets.
See, like, it was see nuts. When you do shit like that, it takes
like they have like yo, because you'll have anime fans going like because when you have a conversation, they'll be like, "Hey, bro, this is so cold, bro, I can't wait." And then like manga fans is like, "Bro, what are you talking about? Like
it shouldn't have happened like that. You just turned Jinbei into goddamn Goku."
They did turn Jinbei into Goku. It was crazy. But I'm laughing, like, I'm just excited because if they're doing that for this little shit, you know they're gonna go nuts on the actual stuff. So
as long as they make sure Kaido is beating them niggas in 4K, I'm cool.
They might. You know they finna cap in that fight.
Oh, yeah, them scabbers swords.
They gonna let Kinemon. Swords,
so
they
you go, know they got
Oh, Kinemon is gonna get up. They gonna jerk this man's bro, off, bro.
Kaido's gonna throw his club. Kinemon gonna block it with one hand, then turn it to a backhand-style sword thing. He's gonna cut his leg, cut his arm. And then Kaido's gonna be like, oh, and then drop on the ground. And then Kinemon's gonna do his, like, they're gonna have his, like, you know, intro box. They're gonna call it Firefox Kinemon. They're gonna have crazy, like, FX with fire flaming everywhere. I know they're gonna do it, bro. I'm prepared.
Ew!
But
get out!
Toei, if you don't show out for my nigga Sanji, I'm slandering. I don't give a fuck. I'm toxic this year. Because I'm tired of dealing with shit. We'll talk about it during Black Otaku's reviews. But the One Piece community, y'all niggas just love to prove me right. What else did I watch? I watched 3 episodes of Tokyo Revengers. I was watching it on YouTube because I couldn't find the password to my sister's Verve. So I would have finished by now, but there was only 3 episodes on YouTube. But for what I saw, I'm enjoying it. I'm just enjoying it. I don't have much of an opinion yet. The main character. Tokyo Revengers.
Oh, okay.
Main character is kind of annoying, but
he is more.
He doesn't get better.
He said, like "Don't get no better."
No, I will say this though.
Go ahead.
He that underground fighting thing that they was doing, and then Mikey comes and they all start bowing and shit. Like, do they do that over in Japan? Like with the gangs and stuff. Like, you got to bow to niggas.
To show respect, yeah, I don't know about I don't know.
Respect,
well, yeah, so. Yakuza, yeah, Yakuza.
But they not
sure.
Yakuza though, right? They just
yeah, they're fucking middle school.
Nah, they're bootleg Yakuza.
Yeah, it's like
they're because they want yet. To, yeah. They want to be Yakuza. Like they're gangs, and they rep the way that their gangs and organizations are structured is literally like a Yakuza.
Either way, I ain't doing that shit.
You know what I'm saying? Oh, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna do it for Mikey. Mikey walk up to me.
Oh,
in
yeah,
middle school.
You got
it. Mikey walk up to me in middle school, and I got a man. Hey, I swallow my pride. What's up, Mikey?
Like, okay, if this shit, like real life, like a bunch of Asian niggas come up to me and tell me to kiss the ring, fucking stab me. Like, I'm not about to kiss the ring.
I'm not
doing
it.
Man, I'm like,
bro. Do that shit in this country?
In my birth, when I was like 4 years old or 3 years old, and I stumbled upon this thing called existence. And I was like, you know what? Existence is pretty cool. It's a double-edged sword. Like, you question your existence sometimes. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, why am I here type of situation? But as you grow older, you start to learn that living and existing is a very awesome concept. So in my strive to continuously live and experience this perpetual spiral of life called existence, if a man named Mikey, and I'm in middle school, knowing what this man could do in middle school, pulling up on niggas, literally, niggas introduction in middle school was, oh, they want to fight? Hold on, right there. Let me go get my stuff. I'll be right back. He comes back. Dude's like, hey, Mikey, what's up, bro? What's up? We can't. He was like, threw the lollipop away. He was and beat the crap out of them. I'm going to swallow my pride and I'll be like, yay, Mikey.
Got it.
Itadaki mas, you know what I'm saying? Whatever. Go ahead, do your thing, brother. So, I'm a go ahead and be smooth. I'm gonna live to fight another day. If they say, hey, bro, why are you bend? I'm say, look, I bend to live. And living is such a great thing.
I'm gonna go ahead and go. Only time my hands in the air if they got a blick, like that shit ass.
Bro. I mean, they could beat me, I'll survive.
Thank like, you.
They,
like, yeah, like I said, what them niggas gonna
do? You not surviving. Yes. Oh,
he don't got no bodies. Mikey ain't got a body.
Mikey don't got a body, but Mikey, you know Mikey want to kill, G.
Okay, but
Mikey
if he
can kill if he really, wants to. Remember. Okay,
yeah, he can beat the shit out of me, but he's not
remember,
gonna
remember
kill me.
Remember why Takemichi went back into the past to prevent. I know this is spoiled. Well, we kind of already spoiled the shit.
But they wasn't in middle school at that time.
No. But I'm saying, what triggered Mikey to go like, hey, bump it. I'm going full dark side. Yeah, was Draken Kun dying? And if I met Mikey post Draken Kun dying, I'm bending the knee.
I'm not talking about that aspect. Like that'll go anybody. Oh bro, I'm gonna tell you this right now. I will walk if I was in those two scenarios, either fucking literally go outside this crib and test a nigga or go to test the Japan. I'm Mikey nigga in Japan. I will go test Mikey in Japan with the full hardest, biggest chest like that, bro. Like any, if I get my ass beat, I get my ass beat, bro. Like
it's different. If I see a man who can roundhouse kick me in less than a second, G, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna be like, hey, bro, be smooth. I'm a lover, not a fighter.
I'm talking about middle school. And my middle school DC. Like, yeah. Middle school DC is not bound down to no niggas.
Nigga, in middle school is
middle school, I'm down, bound down.
Knocked out by a lock. Like fucking roundhouse.
Hey, listen, I ain't tough. I'm not gonna cap for middle school Cam. Middle school Cam was bitch made sometimes. So I'm gonna take my ass and I'm gonna bend.
I wasn't the toughest dude either, bro.
I'm already small, dude. I was Mikey small, but I wasn't Mikey tough. I wanted to be Mikey tough, but I wasn't.
All I'm saying is, when I saw that scene, I was like, "Hey, bro, you could battle the one."
Because the thing, because the thing,
other big homie making these niggas fucking fight for your entertainment. Yeah. Who the fuck are you? like, okay, you beat me with a fucking bat to the engine. Like, what the fuck? Okay, yeah, like, you murdered me. Now you in jail because you made a couple of fucking middle school kids fight.
Like, come on,
that nigga took whatever his name is. I can never get his name right because bitch man can't come out of my mouth.
Takemichi, we're not talking about us.
I know. I'm saying, but
adult Takemichi is a bitch.
It translates
back to him being a kid. He was bitch made through life. So I got Takemichi better than D.
I got another bone to pick with him, bro. When he was walking down the street and the middle school dudes was pressing him, that made me so mad.
That's what I'm saying, bro.
That made me so mad.
Takemichi is for sure bending the knee, G. He was bitch made.
I'm telling you,
and him and his friends too, bro.
Japan, fictional Japan is a funny ass place, bro. You get in middle school, your ass getting beat up in front of other. Where your parents at? You went home, they ain't say nothing.
You just said it, Daytrio. It's an anime. They ain't got no parents. Yeah, they ain't got no parents.
Hey man,
it's an anime. G, they ain't got no parents.
That nigga been living on his own since two.
Like, right,
what happened, bro? Where your teacher? Your teacher ain't saying nothing, my nigga.
The
same
Corbara
wouldn't
have
bowed,
man.
I'm telling you, bro. They
wouldn't
have hated
Corbara
me.
Corbara, Yusuke ain't
bowed. But Corbara, but that's cap because Corbara got fucking powers.
Before he got powers, bro. Remember
talking about before.
Dog walked. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
He was getting dog walked.
But Mikey, but the thing is.
The Corbara bitch out, though.
Mikey is not pressing Corbara because I think Mikey would like Corbara.
Yeah,
like he would. Mikey would be like, "Hey, let's hang. I'm trying to hang with you, bro." Mikey's not that type of person to be like, "Hey, bro, you look strong. I'm gonna beat your ass up."
Like the gripe I got with that show in general, right? It's not just like, "Oh yeah, he a bitch." It's like you unrealistically a bitch. I think every human has a resolve, like, and not the bitch ass resolve that he had. Like every human, because that's in human nature to at a point where you do one thing, you fight or flight. You in that situation in which you getting your ass ran in a fucking fighting ring, you're going to do one thing. You're going to fight to get out of there, or you're going to peel out till you're not having it no more, or you're just going to fucking die. Like, at that aspect, I'm like, bro, you this bitch made. And then in the future, you become part of Mini Yakuza, and you still bitch made. And then as you get older, when you find out you did all this shit, you are still bitch made. That's not a personality trait. That is a mental disorder.
No, that's his character. That's not even a myth. That's literally his. He's a static character.
And that's
man,
tough.
You gotta toughen up. None of his homies, real niggas in that episode. Real niggas can't. Hey, we gonna help you out. We saw your homie.
It's one of them that's a snitch. Chris, no, I think it's one of them that's a snake.
Can I make a guess?
It's not red hair, nigga.
I bet it's that dude with the weak body that he got. Okay, never mind.
I'm not gonna spoil it, but it's one of them that's a snake, dog. Super snake.
Well, that's like manga shit.
No, it's anime.
It actually happened in the anime twice.
It's twice. And it's in the last
twice.
Time out. I'm about to uninstall this game. This is the worst fishing. If you can't hook me in with fishing,
go ahead. Live uninstall.
Do what you gotta do.
Live
uninstall. Do what you gotta do, G. Do what you gotta do. But go ahead, DC. We sorry.
No, you good. Because I think that was it for watching. Reading. I read the One Piece shit. My agenda is in full effect. I'm changed. Like I remember that, you know, that clip, Cam, where you posted a clip from the last week's Black Otaku Reviews episode where I said Sanji and Zoro surpassed
stronger than Ace. Yeah.
Bro, at first I listened to it. I'm like, maybe I was capping. Then this chapter came out. I'm like, nah, I wasn't capping. Nah, I wasn't capping. This confirmed my opinion. So, Ace, y'all can suck a dick if y'all disagree.
Stay tuned for the Black Otaku Reviews. We will talk a lot more in depth about what happened with One Piece. It's a lot things going on.
Yeah, shout out to that chapter. I haven't read the spoilers yet, but I'll take Chris's word for it because my hero been heat for the past couple chapters, so I'm excited for that. I read the Rent-A-Girlfriend chapter, and he tried
to... still going?
Yeah, it's still going.
It's unfortunately still
going. He's been reading the manga, so yeah.
Yeah, I've been reading it. So they all on a vacation. The grandma got a room for the two of them while the rest of them have their own rooms. So he's trying to confess to her.
He's in the room with mommy, right?
Nah, he's in the room with Mizuhara. Mommy's there.
Didn't you say in the last chapter they was like, hey, let's try dating or something like that? Like she confessed to him?
No, she didn't confess to him. What happened? He's trying to confess to her because everybody's here. Was it Ruka, Mommy, all of them are there. So there's like this looming threat that Mommy's going to tell everybody that Mizuhara is just a rental. So he wants to confess to her. So even if like they find out, at least he let his feelings known to her. And if she says yes, then it wasn't a lie type. So he's banking on that. And then the high school chick, she's trying to break
hold
them
on,
up.
Hold on, one second.
What's up?
Think about this question, Chris, because we go revisit this maybe in Black Otaku Reviews. Who's the bigger bitch character, Takamichi or old boy from Rent-A-Girlfriend? That's a dialogue. We can continue, DC.
Rent-A-Girlfriend.
One of them niggas rented a girlfriend.
I'd rather be Takamichi than Kazuya.
I'd rather be Takamichi.
Takamichi got his ass beat to an inch of him, to an inch of his life.
At least, like, there's moments where Takamichi stood up for himself.
He said, I'm not happening. But technically,
we just compared, like, say, for instance, I was in Japan, and God told me, this is you is getting reincarnated. These are the two paths
you take. These are the two paths you got.
Your isekai. Just isekai.
I'm not Kazuya either, bro.
All right, okay, all right. That's fair. I say the same thing. Kazuya is a big
because he's lying to his homies and his family, bro. I can never nah.
At least Takamichi's goal, even though it's to get future pussy, at least his goal of getting future pussy dismantles a Yakuza gang.
But this is the thing: his future, even I don't know how that shit broke up, was low key love, and they had a mutual love for each other in the beginning.
Yeah.
You pulled up on a dating app that involves money. You basically clicked the advertisements on Kiss Anime and saw how far
hot single moms in your area.
That ain't a got to see it through moment at all.
It ain't. But he's trying to confess to Mizuhara. The high school chick's trying to break them up. So, like, she's cock blocking them, and then
Honda come and pull up on her from episode 12? Can that Honda pull up on her, Chris?
You mean a Hummer? That Hummer? That was a Hummer, nigga. Shit, you talking about a Honda? That was a Hummer.
Wide body, but she's trying to break him up. Then the dude, remember his friend that rented the high school chick?
Yeah,
he's also pedophile. There. Yeah, so there's another layer between them because they're acting funny. And then his best friend that doesn't know anything, he's like, why the fuck is everybody acting weird? So he's kind of picking up.
He's like the only good character in that show besides Mizuhara.
That's true. So they all went to their rooms and he's with Mizuhara. So he's about to confess and she sees that he's about to confess. So she runs into the bathroom that she's not ready for it, I guess.
She's
like... And she's like blushing and she's like, don't say it now. So it's like she's feeling him, but she wants him to do it in a different way. So he's trying to rush the confession because he knows some bullshit about to go down. So that's basically where we're at right now.
That sounds like something women would do. You trying to do it one way, but it's like, no, it has to be dramatics.
It's messed up because it would help the situation because if she just let him confess right there, this whole thing would have been fixed.
It's no, but fuck all that. Hey, be on your boss status. Walk up to your grandma and say, I was a simp. I rented a girlfriend. Fuck you gonna do about it? I'm a grown ass man living on my own.
They're gonna take away his inheritance because they've been paying for everything.
Fuck it. Hey, take my money. I'm a simp.
That's his livelihood, bro.
Hey, listen. Grown men gotta fly sometimes. Sink or swim.
He gonna kill himself, bro.
That's all you gotta do. It's basically your way out. I'm saying, bro, but like, it's literally because mommy is, I forgot the tactic. I feel like it's like some Sun Tzu battle Chinese tactics or something like that. But it's literally, I forgot it's a quote for this. It's something to do with like fighting a tiger using a wall or something like that. Where basically you take your enemy's greatest card and you use it against them. Her greatest card is rent a girlfriend, love is not real. Walk up to your grandma, hey, grandma. I rented a girlfriend.
I mean,
What is mommy gonna do? What is she gonna do after
she
that?
She can't do anything.
She can't do anything after that. Because he literally just, her biggest thing to, for her whole pettiness weapon is gone. That's how you end the fucking show. I fucking hate Japan sometimes, dog.
Hey, man.
My thing is, even, you know, this is another reason why I don't watch anime as much. Because I always put like a real man's tactic. If your family have been providing you throughout college and they already know you as a fucking lowlife at that time, you think they're going to stop? Really? I think you went too deep. I think they just love you, fam.
You know, right. And if they your family and you say, hey, I did this messed up thing, I regret it, but I actually genuinely like this chick and she likes me back. If they go, if they like, well, no, you know what I'm saying? Then you literally can't do nothing after that. Chalk it up to the game. That's life. You a grown man. You gotta learn how to roll with the punches.
He don't know. But that's pretty much where we're at with that. I think I read something else, but I fucking forgot. So it is what it is. For gaming, I got hopped back on Rainbow for like 2 seconds. Hop the fuck back off. And that's pretty much it.
I got to stop playing these Ubisoft games.
Bro, that's the only game
you want. I don't think it's not Europe at all. You're not that. That is
absolutely I don't blame you.
I don't got any other, like, we tried to play Apex. I don't like that shit.
I don't blame you.
Apex sucks too.
Yeah, who do you share your system with?
Miles.
Miles ain't fucked. Got no game.
Yeah, and Miles.
So you need to.
Miles with say, PC.
Can he still attach to one of ours, Cam? Or that's just with a PS5?
PS5, you can add more.
Yeah, PS5, I think you could add more. But I think PS5 it's like can add more. We would have to do more stuff to it.
Yeah.
Because it's 3 ways, not 2 ways. And I'm not trying to. That's a lot of a headache. I ain't going to lie.
Hey, bro. Look, man. When's your birthday?
September.
I'll give you a new game. I mean,
it's all good because, like, I usually, in terms of gaming, I usually game anywhere from 11 to 11:50 because I'm doing it before I go to sleep. So, I mean, it does its job. It puts me right to sleep because I'm fucking tired of this shit. But I don't know. My gaming life is depressing. My Switch holding me out, but I don't really get the time to play with that either. So it is what it is. But yeah, that's it for me.
All right. So for me, let's see. Speaking of Mikey, when my hair is let down, you know how like Mikey kind of has those kind of like edges to his skin? Like my hair looks like that, like Mikey's hair down. I kind of like it like that, but other than that, let's see, reading everything that I read we will discuss in Black Otaku Reviews. So One Piece, My Hero, Black Clover, super and Boruto, but don't expect Super and Boruto. Do not expect me to add like chapter stuff and stuff. I'm not doing that shit. That's like 50 pages. Fuck all that shit.
It's too many pages.
And
bad especially reviewing. Imagine a review of 50 pages of Boruto, man.
Especially with Boruto, because that was a fucking ass chapter this week.
You read?
I went on a rant because I read it before I played Ratchet and Clank. So like one of my Ratchet and Clank recordings, I literally ran on a rant because that's how dumb that chapter was. They need to end that shit now because there's literally nothing of worth. I know people are saying that the anime got like, I find it fucking hilarious that whenever somebody brings up Boruto, it's always a fight with Naruto and Sasuke.
Somebody brought that up, G. I cried.
That has to say something about the quality of that series and how fucking
really bad,
how fucking trash it is, dog. Kishimoto.
I'm gonna keep it 100 with you, bro. That's not a top 10 fight. I watched it. That it was all right.
Like niggas was overhyping it because it was Naruto.
It's Sasuke, yeah.
Yeah,
but that's niggas it. Comparing it to the movie fight. I'm like, bro, do we have to repost that shit?
Come on, bro. This nigga was flying and then legend. they stabbed Naruto.
He was just talking cash shit.
Yeah, bro. Like it wasn't even as fight as much as a confrontation. That's that. So I'll do playing last because I want to go into my Scarlet Nexus impressions. But for watching, since we talked about majority of the stuff, the two shows that I watched that ended were, well, three. These Snow White Notes ended last week. That ending was very depressing. Like the main character, like he lost. So he lost the individual tournament, of course, because you can't win a tournament arc being a main character. And basically, like, he's like a genius at the Shamisen, and like all of his after he won, like, because his conflict is everybody wants him to play as his granddad, and he wants to find his own sound. So for his selection, he played the first half like his granddad, and he played the rest of it to his sound. And then afterwards, people were like, the main thing that his mom wants him to do, she's a piece of shit, just like we was talking about with the other anime Chris. She was, but she's hot, so I like her. So she was like, I want you to play like your granddad. And she got mad when he started to play it like himself. So at the end, when she was handing him the trophy because he came in third place, she dropped the trophy in front of him. And then she walked up to him. And he was like, "You're a disappointment." So then he has like this rival dude. The rival dude walks up and he's like, You don't play to win. It's like literally everybody who was important to him in that season, in which needed to show him support because he was kind of torn up about losing. They were all like, yo, you fucking suck. Fuck you. I mean, that performance was good and all, but you ain't got the drive to win and all this other stuff. And like the show ended with him crying in like his room. And then like his granddad goes like, his granddad is dead, but like the spirit of his granddad goes like, hey, stop trying to steal my song, nigga. And then he like reaches for his shamisen, and then the show ends. I was just like, what the fuck is this? And I was just like, you're not going to get it. I know I'm not going to get a season two. Like, this show was not that popping, so I'm not going to get a season two. You just ended on, like, the worst cliffhanger ever. I'm like, dog, like, I fuck with the main character. He was just like, fuck this nigga for this final episode. And I hate that. Like I said before, I'm starting to, like, really dislike this trope. I absolutely, like, I know, like, you remember how Giga was like, I love tournament arcs. I fucking hate tournament arcs now. I genuinely don't like tournament arcs. Because all tournament arcs are the fucking same, except for like, with the exception of Yu Yu Hakusho. All tournament arcs are literally the same. The main character, the team, the main character, whoever, is not going to win. What's the point? I know that some people use it to establish stronger characters and shit like that, but to me, that's just so bland. You can do it some other way. So I just like, why are you giving me this tournament arc? I know they're not going to win, and that shit annoys me. So all in all, I would say for a music anime, because the only reason why it appealed to me is because I fuck with the shamisen. But if you don't like music anime, avoid this. I mean, it's like I said before, it's not that deep or anything like that. The music selections are nice, but the plot, the characters, and other thing like that in the tournament arc was ass. So other than that, excuse me, Miss Nagataro.
Oh, that's what it was. That's what it was. That's what I forgot.
So Megaloboxing is probably my number, depending on how this last episode goes, will determine where I place it as far as my seasonal anime. But if it's not number one, then Miss Nagataro will be. I fucking love this show. Like, this show was really good. I like it, even though it's weird because I, you know, college and stuff. I like this show better than Uzaki-chan. Because I think the chemistry between the two main characters is way better.
Yeah, I agree.
Uzaki and the main character. I don't even know that nigga's name.
It's Senpai.
He has a name. His name one time in the manga.
Yeah, he has a name, but yeah. It's
no. I'm talking senpai. About Uzaki-chan.
Oh, Uzaki-chan. I forgot my man's name.
I don't know. Oh, Sakurai, they say, right? I think. Oh, yeah, the relationship. The relationship between Nagataro and Senpai are way better. That and the fact that the faces, too. I think it's the faces. It's just like how... Shout out to that man's hentai experience. But the faces that he be drawing on Nagataro is absolutely hilarious. But yeah, the final two episodes was good. I hope we get a season two. Because I heard that there's some really good stuff that happens in the manga. That I would like to see.
Yeah.
Like, I know I got spoiled that, like, he's learning boxing or something. Like, he's learning to do something in the manga.
Yeah.
So I want to see that in the future. So I highly recommend. That show is hilarious. It's slice of life, but it's funny as hell slice of life. And definitely one of the high notes of this season of anime. And one of the mid notes is Tokyo Revengers. That final episode pissed me off because it just wasn't good. I think that it's one of those things where they better be grateful that they confirmed that it's going to continue on to the summer season, because if it ended like this, I would have dropped the show. The show would have been dropped. That ending it's abysmal. I understand what they're trying to do as far as like, well, you know, you change the future, but, you know, the future isn't all the way changed. Like, you change one thing, but it all leads up to the same thing. But it's like, I had to put up with this nigga's bitchness for like 11 episodes. The crying and all this other shit, just for you to finally achieve your goal, and you can't form a sentence out of your mouth to tell her, I love you, let's hook up together. Ample time after time after time after time after time in that episode, he could have just been like, literally at her apartment, yo, let's talk. Hey, you know, shit happened. I still like you. Boom. Instead, you Well, oh, well, let's drive. Let's do it. I was like, what is going on? And then, like, when she's at the scene, I don't want to spoil too much because DC and the trailer are watching, but, like, when he does the scene and then he's like, oh, let me go to the bathroom, I'm like, I was already knowing that something bad was going to happen when he went to the bathroom. And I'm just like, bro, this is so fucking stupid. And then he goes like, I'm gonna sit. I'm like, bro, like, this is not how you do it. Like, I literally, throughout this entire episode, it wasn't a frustration of, I want to see what happens next. It was a frustration of, damn, I really like Mikey and Draken, so that's the only reason why I want to continue to watch the show.
And this episode had no Mikey or Draken.
And this episode had no Mikey and no Draken. Just bitch made Takemichi from beginning to end. And it was bad. It was bad. So, crazy. Yeah, I don't... That's like... I just don't... I don't know, bro. That shit was ass. But other than that, I did pick up... I'm not going to talk so much about it. I just say that I have my next sports anime that I'm going to watch, Eye Shield 21.
Hey, let's go.
I'm let's liking go. It so far. I like the premise of, like, the main character being, like, he got bullied all his... He got bullied when he was in, like... He's in middle school, right? Or high school in Eye Shield.
He started in middle school, and he's in high school now, I believe.
Okay, he's in high school. Like, he got bullied throughout all his, like, to be a gopher, basically going and buying shit. And because he did all that stuff as a kid, he's, like, one of the fastest niggas ever. So
and he's able to just see routes.
Yeah, he's able to see. He has Shuriken on the football field, and he's able to, like, do 40-yard dashes and shit like that.
Yeah,
hold on. It's kind of... I would have to tamper your expectations because it is a pretty old
it's mid 2000s.
Yeah, it's not, but the animation's not bad. Like, when he actually starts running shit like that, I'm like, oh, this animation is pretty fucking solid for it to be kind of an older school anime. But I like that. And then on to the best thing that I've watched this entire week, Fast 9 or Furious 9, whatever they call it, F9, the Fast Saga. Holy shit. I am not gonna lie. So I'm gonna put it like this. I wish I drunk during that movie. I didn't drink because my god brothers. But that movie, because I already knew this movie was gonna be stupid from jump. So I did not go into this movie expecting like oh man, I'm gonna get like, I literally turned my brain off. It was funny too because we had some people sitting behind us and we was just like, every time something stupid happened, we would all just laugh or commentate over the entire movie. It was fucking hilarious. Like, there's a part in the movie where Tyrese's character, he's talking to Ludacris and the hacker chick, and he literally breaks the fourth wall. He goes like, "How many times have we been on this adventures?" And he's like, "Every time we go into something, we end up living through those situations." Like, it was an earlier scene where it was like 14 niggas. It was like a militia army, 14 niggas surrounded Tyrese's character. He was underground. They had the high ground. They was all pointing his guns at him. All he had was a bulletproof, you know, vest on. And he had like, I think he had like an AK. And he literally picked his AK up and started shooting them. And they are all shooting at him and the bullets are like hitting his vest. But when you look after the scene, his like shirt area and stuff have bullet holes in them, but there's no blood. There's another scene where like they go into this minefield area, right? And they have to drive a certain speed so that the mines don't affect them. He gets trapped in a mine, like his car flips over and it's like between these two boulders and there's a mine directly below him. So he forces himself out the window. He lands on the ground right like centimeters away from the mine, tripping. He gets up, his car falls, he runs away, triggers the explosion, car jumps up, he's like, okay, I survived. Then the car comes, and the way it is, the car comes crashing, it looks like it lands on top of him. He walks out and he's like, and then Ludacris's character is like, how are you not dead? And he's like, and then he explains in the scene, he's like, we always in these scenarios in which we should die, but we don't die. And then Ludacris is like, oh, does that mean like we got some kind of like superpowers or something like that. If
he all the just fact started. That they're joking at themselves now, G, is where we're at with this series.
This movie confirms that they know that the Fast series is a meme. They full on embraced how meme they know that people only watch this movie to see how stupid they outperform themselves. The whole plot synopsis of this movie is stupid. So John Cena's character, right, is Don Toretto's long lost brother. But the way they set up the revenge is that, like, so their dad used to be like a NASCAR driver, whatever, right? The way they set it up is it's believed that, like, so they were like both engineers at like the pit stop. And it's like John Cena's character, when he was a younger kid, he tampered with the car, which basically led to the car exploding and killing the dad. And then later on, when they went to go get his dad's thing, there's some dude who showed up who was basically talking shit. I think Dom like beats him to death. He goes to jail. And then it's like John Cena is mad. And he's like, I've always lived in your shadow. And then like, I think me and then some other dude in the back was like, but nigga, your brother was in jail. How are you living in his shadow when the nigga is in jail? Yeah. So I have to talk about one scene in particular, and I'll wrap up my review. The space scene. Holy shit. That was the dumbest fucking thing I have ever seen in movie cinema. So y'all know the niggas from Tokyo Drift, right? So yeah. Shad was there. Shad was in the movie.
Hey, Shad Moss won this weekend.
Yeah, Shad was in the movie. They had the main character from Tokyo Drift and some other nigga. So they were working on strapping up rocket cars to cars in order to make them go fast. So using that, they also have a jet that I guess they have. So they use the jet to propel a car. I don't know what type, because like space, there's a lot of pressure in space. I don't know if they knew that, but I don't know if a car can handle the pressure in space, but we're not going to talk about that. We're turning our brains off. So they detach the car from the jet, and then they use the rockets to propel it into space. And then they detach the rockets, and they're literally in orbit, and they're actually driving the car in orbit. I kid you not. It has no wheels on it, but like they're using their engineers. So they have to stop this satellite. And this is the dumbest shit ever. But the plot of it is that John Cena's character is trying to collect these two pieces of this thing called Ares. And when you combine it and you uplink it to a satellite, it'll literally control everything. It's a code that controls everything. So all weapon systems, everything like that, they'll be able to control it using Ares and uplinking it to the satellite. So Tyrese and Ludacris's character, they have to drive into space because they can't disable the uplink on ground. They have to actually physically go into space to stop the satellite from uplinking. I know, Deshra, that's the exact reaction I had. So they have to use this like magnetic equipment to disable the satellite, but it doesn't work. So what happens is, and Tyrese has another statement, and this is like a dramatic scene. This is supposed to be really dramatic because they're playing sad music. Everything's in slow-mo. And they're like, he's like, guys, like he's talking to Ludacris' character. He's like, we always survive these death-defying encounters. And he's like, maybe this is the one time where we don't survive. And the whole theater is laughing, dog. So what they do is he hits the NAS in space and they drive into the satellite and blow the satellite up in space, and they survive. And then they run into like an official US satellite, which helps them go back down to Earth.
your ass tweaking. You tripping, get the fuck off my phone.
Dog, I have to tell. So if y'all saw the last movie with the whole submarine shit and like them surviving like flames and stuff, this movie out Oh my God. Okay, one more scene I have to talk about is the fucking, so this is like in the this is like the first 20 minutes of the, it's funny because somebody even, somebody in the theater said it, like, this is only the first 20 minutes of the film and they doing stupid shit. So they're driving in like this, I forgot where they were. It's like this cliffy area and they're, and what they're trying to do is John Cena took one half of the thing that's needed to do Ares. So he drives, he hits the Nas, he drives off the cliff. And then this freaking jet swoops in, and the jet has like these this like magnetic pulsers on the ground. Like if y'all saw the trailer, he jumps off the cliff. The jet swoops in, picks him up, and he goes off like fucking magnet. So then, Tyrese, Ludacris, and the hacker chick, they drive over the bridge. So they, so it's a car that comes behind them that destroys the bridge as they're driving on the bridge with like a fucking tank, right? The bridge is actively falling as they're driving up it to get to the other side. So they're able to defy all laws of physics and gravity and drive up the fucking bridge to get to the other side. Dom, who is a god, this movie confirms that Dom is a god. Like he, like in the other ones, like he's Superman, but now he's like god tier. He takes one of, so he drives into like one of the bridge posts that has a rope. Drives off of it, turns his wheel, the rope attaches to like the wheel, and it swings them across the bridge. The car bumps into a rock, flips on the other side. Bear in mind, they're not wearing seatbelts at all when all this is happening. Flips up, the car lands, turns around, glass is breaking, boom, they go on the other side, and they're perfectly fine. All this to say, this movie is a fucking, if you want to see a fun, I'm talking about like, this movie isn't even comedy, but this is one of the funniest shit in media that I have seen this year. If you go to into this movie, and I'm telling you, turn your brain off. Don't think, don't question it, just watch and enjoy it. This is one of the best movies I have seen this year. I would give this movie a 10 out of 10. This is the perfect turn your brain off and just enjoy. I would also recommend drinks. Have some drinks while you're watching the movie because I feel like this is a good tipsy movie. So if you want to lose brain cells, if you just want to have some fun, laugh, and not take shit seriously, do yourself a favor and watch this movie. Support this movie because it's funny because they point towards the moon in one of the ending scenes. So it's like, they're teasing that they might go to the moon.
They're going to the moon. They're going to the moon.
I need to see that shit. I need to see Fast 10 and I need to see them go to the moon. So please support this movie. But if you go into this movie and I'm telling you, if you ask one question, you are not going to like this movie. So go into this movie. You know what I'm saying? This is a perfect movie. Take your boo thing out, take your shorty out. You know what I'm saying? Whoever is your significant other. Go to this movie, and I'm telling y'all, y'all go laugh y'all ass off. It's a funny-ass movie, and you can talk about the stupid shit that happens to this movie. So shout out to Fast 9. It was a great film. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm not even lying. I'm not capping. I thoroughly enjoyed this movie.
Hey. It is what it is when it comes to that, G. Like, I know it's good, but at the same time, that shit getting a little too far.
Yes.
The initial reception for the movie from what I've seen so far is it's good reception other than the people saying the Fast series is ruined. Like, we're not fucking 9 movies into the series.
The Fast series has been ruined since they started doing death-defying stunts and shit.
Since they hopped to another fucking building.
This movie is self-aware. So at this point, I think the directors, they know that we don't expect some kind of like holy shit, deep thinking, you know what I'm saying? Like, I understand the depths of humanity type of situation, like Oscar bait shit, right? This movie is very self-aware. It's very self-aware how dumb they are, how dumb everything they're doing is, how they always defy physics and shit like that. And because of that, I can't hate on this movie too much. I can't. They're self-aware.
It broke the pandemic record because technically, you know, everything's not open.
Oh, yeah.
It broke the pandemic record.
That's perfect. Brilliant strategy. They released it at the perfect date, so I ain't mad at that. But on to playing Aside from Ratchet and Clank, the only other thing that I've been playing this week, I finished Integrate. I wanted to talk about that. I finished Integrate. All I'm gonna say is, if y'all niggas was asking questions at the end of the remake, this DLC. So for all my Zack fans, all my Zack Fair fans, this ending, the ending to the DLC, chef's kiss. Hey, I know a lot of niggas don't like Nomura, and I kind of don't care, but Nomura literally was like, hey, I'm going to basically say that whatever you expected in Remake 2, I'm going to flip it up again. I don't want to spoil anything, because just in case they Cheryl and Chris want to play the DLC later on.
Which I plan to.
Yeah. I saw the ending already. It was, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, I don't want to spoil it for you, Chris, but, like, that ending was fucking wild. I was literally, the next episode that I'm going to upload, which is the last episode of Integrate, I literally, like, spent, like, the last 10 minutes of the recording session talking about theorizing, like, what the fuck does this mean? What happens next? I'm excited for Remake 2. Remake 2 is going to be fucking flames. But Integrate was really good. Buy it, support it. It's worth the money.
Before you go, so it's gonna be four parts.
No, I think they said three.
It's three.
Max talking about fucking four.
I think they said initially. I think they Square confirmed that it's gonna be three parts.
Yeah, I could have sworn I remember hearing three.
Yeah. All right. Cool.
Because I think how I see Remake 2 going, they can squeeze a lot of shit. And then they can make how I think they're going to end Remake 2. Now, if they decide to really do traditional Final Fantasy shit, I would say that they would end Remake 2 with Sephiroth killing Aeris.
That's the best way to go about it.
Because of how that end credit scene went.
But depending on how things go, because there's a lot of shit that ending scene implies, she may not be dying. That's all I'm gonna say. She may not be dying.
Yeah, because this is something I probably want to talk to you outside the podcast. But what Max was talking about, they said, because people saying it's because the game is technically not a remake; it's something else.
Yeah, it's not. Yeah, like I think even Nomura or some people, like some of the producers of the game, said that like Remake 2 is going to be very different than the original. Like, it's not going to be a complete retelling of Final Fantasy VII. And that's going to offend some people, but all I'm going to say is Remake has made me actually give a shit about Final Fantasy VII. Because
near perfect game. That game was amazing. Like, come on.
Because all I'm going to say is OG Final Fantasy VII, mid at best.
I want to say this thing too. And I want to know if you went through it, because I got to watch the series. That difficulty, huh?
That final boss for Integrate is, I don't know what the music is fire too, but that final boss of Integrate, you unlock hard mode later, right, as a challenge difficulty. Normal, he kicked my ass. I barely won the fight. Barely won that fight. And I was prepared. I made sure to be prepared going into this boss battle, and I barely won. I had to rely on a summon to finish the job. That's how bad it was. He kicked my... It's like he drains health continuously. He can, like, do this thing where, like, if you don't dodge at the right time, it explodes, and then it deals a shit ton of damage. The good thing is that your party member... Sonon, and I'm not gonna spoil anything, but Sonon is a real ass fucking nigga. I love that nigga. Sonon has this ability where he fully revives. If Yuffie dies and he's still alive, he fully revives you with max HP and MP, but then he kills himself. So he dies. So, but you can kind of low key cheese it by just bringing him back to life.
Yeah,
and if you die, he just do it over. He'll do it. It's not a one time. He'll continuously do it over and over.
Oh, again. Okay.
He still has to be alive while you
just die. Gotta have a crap ton of revives to keep it.
But it's a really good ability. Sonon is such a good character. But yeah, I really enjoyed Integrate, and I can't wait to see what happens in Remake 2. Other than that, Ratchet and Clank is still going good. I am almost done. I just got done after the part where you encounter where Emperor Nefarious, the Rivets Nefarious comes in, kicks ass, and then takes the other Nefarious and disappears. That shit was low-key lit. His voice actor's cold too. I like that. I like that introduction scene. It's pretty
really cool. Good game. Like, you almost done. How you feeling about? I don't want to spoil. How you feeling about the Rivet and what's the orange robot?
Oh, Kit. Their relationship.
Oh, okay. You ain't at that point yet.
I didn't. I. They just got together.
Okay. All right. You'll get there.
But I Kit is kind of cool. Like, I liked her little dynamic that she had with Ratchet for a while.
I thought they was gonna do the switch. I thought Clank was gonna stay with Rivet.
Yeah, I thought originally he was gonna be like, yo, I kind of want to stay with Rivet.
Yeah, I was enjoying the Rivet and the Ratchet.
Rivet and Clank. Yeah, that was they had some really good dynamics with them. And Ratchet had some good dynamics with Kid as well. But yeah, I'm enjoying the game so far. And then the last thing that I have been playing, shout out to the fireworks, is Scarlet Nexus. So this game came out, I believe, Thursday. And this is a Bandai Namco game. However, this is a non-mainstream anime Bandai Namco game. So this is actually made with a bit of competence. I like this game a lot. I didn't follow up on this game when it was initially released. I remember the E3 that it got announced. It wasn't E3 it got announced. It was that Xbox game show that it got announced.
Yes, Xbox.
I remember that. And I was like, yeah, this looks pretty decent. You know what I'm saying? Bootleg Kirito main character. They let it on as a hack and slash. But the thing that drew me into this game was the style of it reminds me a lot. And this is for my Switch peeps, but Astral Chain is a hack and slash Switch exclusive. Fucking love that game. Highly slept on. Very good game. And it reminds me of the style of that game reminds me a lot of that. So that's why I was very interested in playing it. And I'm digging the premise. So the premise of the game is basically there's two protagonists you could choose from: Bootleg Kirito and the waifu of the game, the chick with the silver hair.
I'm sorry. I'm listening to you. But basketball was safe.
Oh, okay. I got you.
This nigga just fucking flopped. And I hate basketball. Go ahead, Cam. My bad.
Oh, no. You good. But basically, I chose Bootleg Kirito. And essentially, there's this organization called the OSF, which is a military zone that fights these things called Others, which are basically monsters of the universe. And the only way you can beat them is by using psychokinetic powers. Each person that you encounter has a different type of kinetic power. So the main character has psychokinesis, which is basically he can manipulate and move objects. There's a chick who has pyrokinetics, which is flames. There's the dude who can turn invisible. There's this chick who can like see invisible objects. There's a dude who has electricity kinetics, like really interesting concepts. Some dude has ice. Some dude can use it to teleport places. A lot of cool shit. So the way the gameplay works is you only control the main character whose ability is to just move objects and shit. However, you can, what they call SAS, I don't know what it stands for, but basically you link up with one of your party members and you can borrow their abilities. So you can borrow the chick who has pyrokinetics. You can borrow the dude who has invisibility powers. And that's kind of how they mix the gameplay. Yeah,
when they first did the tutorial, when they was like, use it, and it said press square, triangle. I thought that was a combo. I'm like, hold on, man.
Oh, no, Cam, I noticed that too, G. I was like, huh? And I watched your thing last night. I was like, huh?
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's one of those. So, and the reason why this reminds me of Astral Chain, because Astral Chain, it's like, if you know Devil May Cry 5 and how fucking complicated those combos can be, it's not like that. This is one of those games that has like, you press square to do a light attack, you press triangle to do a heavy attack, but you can link a lot of shit together to make your combos pop. So it's like, yeah, you only have a basic ass square combo, but you can link your square combo to your kinetic powers. Then you can use, then you can sync up with your party member, use flame attacks and shit. Like it's a lot of things that you can do that doesn't make the like in the next episode that I'm about to upload, there's so much shit as far as like gameplay that happens that I'm just like, wow, I really like this. Like the dude who has invisible powers, you can use his powers to walk up to an enemy. You like stab them in the back, and then you can do a special like cutscene attack where the main character does some raw ass shit. It's really good. Story wise, I don't really know. I'm not gonna say too much. Aside from the fact that it's kind of one of those conspiracy type things where the military organization that you're working for is experimenting with the powers. So there's a lot of behind the scenes stuff going on that you have to untangle. But I will say, as first impressions goes, I think that if you like the kind of hack and slash adventure type games, you're going to like this game. Characters are really good. The story is cliche, but it's a good cliche. It's one of those things where I'm not expecting a 10 out of 10 masterpiece or something like that. It's what I get. I'm okay with it. But the gameplay to me is the high note. The way that you can link up combos, the way that they use the psychokinesis powers, it's all really good. So I would say that, yeah, pick this game up. If you have the chance to, it's on PS4, it's on PS5. Play it. Good. And that's it.
It was all right. Like the 5 minutes I played this game. Wait, 41 minutes technically, but half of it is the podcast. It's decent. It's nice. I ain't got the review like you do. And you know, they gave me that option. They gave me that whole circle to skip that dialogue.
Yeah, I will say, I noticed a lot of bad, like this is the only bad thing I would say. Because I noticed this a lot in Bandai Namco games. The fucking slideshow cutscenes. I don't understand why they do that. And it's like, the cutscenes that they have in which the characters like actually do shit looks really good. So it's like, instead of, I know Demon Slayer sells, right? Instead of wasting money on that Naruto Storm clone game with you popping characters like those two kids who got killed in episode 2 or some shit and saying that, yes, this is the highlight. This is who's coming to our game and telling us that like you're the demon character, like it's hard to balance the demon characters in the game. Like they said something like the reason why they haven't dropped, like, because the only people that they've dropped, the only demon that they've got in the game that we know so far is Nezuko. They haven't dropped any of the other villains as playable characters yet. And they're saying that because they don't know how to balance them for the game. And it's like, nigga, you made the Storm series. Exactly. What the fuck are you talking about? like, what are you talking about? So yeah, it's dumb. But like, yeah, the anime slideshow cutscenes are bad. But I will say it's caveated by the voice acting is like the English voice acting, because I'm playing it on English, is actually good. So it's not, I'm not, it's grating, but the voice acting carries it. So.
I was at a party, I was like, all right, I'm about to try out Scarlet Nexus. And they was like, hey, Dom was like, hey man, how you liking that slideshow? How you liking that visual novel? I'm like, huh? And then soon, nigga pop on the screen like this. I'm like, dog.
That's it?
Yep, that's it.
So, y'all been watching Loki? Just to be sure.
Yeah, I watched Loki. 2 and 3, right? Because we didn't talk about 2 or 3.
Yeah, we didn't watch 2, so okay. Who wants to do episode 2? And I'll do episode 3.
Can you, like, can, you know, condense them bitches?
All right, we're going to try to condense this. Good.
Episode 3 was fucking mid. I'm going to say it like that.
I like 3.
I like 3, too.
3 was really good.
I'm actually on Daytrail's side. I was low-key looking at my phone sometimes.
I say, like, the dialogue in 3, in terms of, like, how they was talking between the two Lokis was nice. I think
But everything happening around them was kind of like, what?
Yeah. I will say like, this, though. I thought, and I don't know if y'all know this much in the Marvel comics, but when I saw that moon collage, I was like, did they just go into a universe when there was an incursion, dog? And I was going to be, my mind was going to fucking blow. I was like, Kenneth Feig is a fucking, you know, okay, quick, you know, sad about. And Incursion, basically, you know how they got rid of the Marvel Ultimate Universe?
Yeah.
And the
yeah.
Marvel Comic Universe? They smashed the two Earths together. So that's why Miles Morales and
Peter Parker in the same world and stuff.
The same world and shit like that. And that's why, you know, the Fantastic Four is not a thing anymore in the comics because of that. They're too busy making more universes. Mm. Right. I thought that was that. I'm like, bro, that's a fucking Incursion, dog. Then it turns out, hey, a moon just obliterated fucking everybody, dog. I would say the scene when happening. The moon was, when that shit hit, I'm like, all right, this is some beautiful shit right here.
But yeah, the cinematics were really good.
I was like, eh. I know there was a story behind. I think, too, in terms of, like, I think episode one and two establishing Loki's character was really, really fucking good. It was really fucking good. But that fucking three, I was like, I don't give a fuck about Loki, bitch. Or bitch Loki, you know, flip it how you want.
I just didn't like, I also didn't like how the episode ended. It was just like, it just stood there and then she just walked away.
Yo,
and
somebody got to throw a mission fail on that scene, G, because that was a mission fail ass reaction.
It's just like, oh, because I guess they were trying to head towards the building or something, and it was like, oh,
and then crashed. Like, no, like the arc, no, something crashed into the arc.
Oh yeah, and then like then just the way it's just so abrupt, and then she just disappeared behind the extras behind the scene, and then show, and then it was like, all right, we'll see you in episode four. I was like, what? Like three, I think three was good as far as character, but. It's funny. Two was good because of
story lore. Building. Lore building. Story
Owen
lore
Wilson, building. Owen Wilson carried episode one and two.
Yeah. Owen Wilson, G. And three was good because of the interactions between the two Lokis. Or what did she call herself? Sylvie?
Sylvie.
Yeah. But everything that happened around, I didn't really care about that. Like the whole arc and the world that they were on. Is that like important in comic books? Like, is that planet important?
My knowledge.
No.
I'm pretty sure it has a moment, but that's when you'll have to go on a YouTube video for like a comics explain or some shit. Oh, yeah. But from my knowledge, not really.
But I think episode two, so I think the highlights in episode two, if we want to condense it, were so the Loki establishing how Sylvie is bullshit. Not messing up the timeline. Who won?
No, they just fouled out fucking Devin Booker, G. Like that's I don't call that shit in no damn.
Oh, he got fouled out?
Yeah.
He's on the Suns, right?
Yeah.
Oh, that's I want that team to win. Oh damn, that sucks. But yeah, so Loki explaining how Sylvie is basically not alerting the time patrollers as far as creating like paradoxes or nexus events, I think is what they called it, by going to apocalyptic events. And because that timeline is basically done, nothing matters because there's not going to be any branches because it's not going to continue because boom goes the dynamite. I think that was pretty cool. I like how they explained that. Even though still, if you want to go outside and talk about butterfly effects and shit like that, I mean, you're still creating events, but we're not going to go into that. I'm going to let Marvel do its thing. And then I would say the other highlight would be the conversation that he had with the judge chick, where she was saying that, like, the timekeepers are like very attached to the case. So like whatever the two Lokis are doing, they're very concerned about what's happening in this thing. And then the conversation that Owen Wilson and Loki had while they're at the cafeteria, where Loki was saying that if everything is predestined, do we really have free will or something like that? I like that dialogue that they had, because it did kind of raise a question of like, if that is set up, like he was basically questioning, do we have free will? Is what we're doing, is that all predestined and all the other stuff? So I think episode two was good as far as establishing the, what's they called it? The actual patrol unit. What do they call them? Time variance
TVA.
Authorities?
TVA.
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 So establishing more about them, establishing how Sylvie is doing what she's doing. And also the conversation about timekeepers. I'm thinking, you think they go dick tease us? Like, do you think they're going to show the timekeepers in the series?
I don't think they exist.
I was going to say like they probably died or something.
Yeah, because I did my slight Marvel research on the timekeepers. They not as hype as they try to make them out to be. And that's why I think the Lokis will learn.
He always do like a bait and switch.
Yeah.
Like he never, I shouldn't say the way the landscape is, it's never so much of this is the way it is. Like, for all we know, they open a timekeeper's door and it's fucking Superman on a typewriter or some shit. You know what I'm saying? It's never the way, like, the Loki.
Or it's Owen Wilson. Owen Wilson's the timekeeper. Owen Wilson,
like, the Loki situation, we look at it, is Loki. The WandaVision is Agatha. You know what I'm saying? You know, evil Captain America. It's always like a bait and switch in things of what he do. I don't think the timekeepers, I think the timekeepers are important. And they also are. Think that would be like the redeeming factor for female Loki, I would say. It's because, like, you know, these timekeepers are evil and things.
Man, I really don't. I guess, I mean, she'll grow on me, but like, she kind of.
Hey, no, the character.
She's there. For now, she's there to me.
The character ain't doing it for me either. Oh, yeah, that's off on Paul George. Damn. The character ain't doing that for me either. But I will say this. I would say, like, in terms of, like, you know, on the way they built the timekeeper's authority as this, like, higher than authority was really, really nice. And they did a couple of things else to make it be like, okay, our crutch is not about to be the Infinity Stones, right? In terms of power in this universe.
Mm.
Wanna know how? Because we use these as paperweights.
That was because, a slight. And also magic does not exist in that part of the world too.
So they're like, okay, this is it's not a crutch for us. You know, I mean, it's not a crutch for them to say the only power is this. You know, it could bring other universal threats in and the Infinity Gauntlet ain't something that can, you know, can deal with it, I think. You know, this is one of those series where you can't really pinpoint where it's gonna go. Like a WandaVision, because all these episodes building up to movies. All these, yeah they all building up to movies. But this one, I can't really think. You think it's probably like a Guardians type thing? I don't know if it's Thor.
This is definitely leading up more towards Doctor Strange.
No, it's not movie. Thor, because Thor is about the female shape.
Yeah. This is going to lean more towards Doctor Strange's you did to me. I don't think he's going to appear.
But that's WandaVision, though.
Both. Yeah. But I think both can, because this involves dimensions and universes and shit, too.
It's possible they set up both, though, because the elements that, like, from what I've been researching as well, that the time stuff is a Thor comic thing, the TVA.
Mm-hmm. Or like maybe they do a Nexus event that triggers Jane getting her powers or something.
I don't know, but I think it's setting up multiple movies rather than just one specific movie. I think it's seeding into multiple.
It could be that, definitely.
It's like, what do they have in seed? Like, because I don't know, but it might be a phase. I don't know, because didn't they say Spider-Man is Loki go do some multiverse shit?
Yeah. So
well, it could be like Spider-Man.
This, yeah.
Everything I don't know about anything else though. Like maybe
Spider-Man
Guardians.
And I think Doctor Strange, because he's messing Doctor with Strange. The multiverse too.
Black Panther, no, because that's not gonna be a thing. Blade. I don't know. No. Maybe Fantastic Four.
I mean, they're doing the time stuff too, like they're introducing Kang and for another movie, I forgot what they said it was.
Yeah,
for.
What movie is he supposed to be in? Kang the Conqueror?
Quantum Mania or something?
Yeah, he's supposed to be an Ant-Man. He's supposed to be an Ant-Man.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Definitely Ant-Man, because
you know, they use Ant-Man to really set up shit, but they know people don't give a fuck about it, but they make you want to go see it.
That's the real Marvel watcher.
Wow, bro.
I like those movies.
Those movies are fire, yeah.
I think Loki is really, really good. I think, you know, it started out really, really strong. I hope it don't dip, you know, because it's always a fatigue when it comes to superhero shit. It's always.
This isn't superhero, though, Detroit.
I mean, my bad.
Anti-hero.
It's always a fatigue, you know what I'm saying? But I think this is nice. It kept me, the first two episodes kept me literally on my eyes on the screen. That third episode, though.
Third episode, I was low key.
I was at work like, shit. I'll lose it to a customer. I'd be like, yeah, yeah, okay, I can do that for you. I watch it locally. I'm talking to the customer fully like, Jack, yeah, man, that's an affinity you got? No, yeah, we both.
I was doing some stuff on Legends and stuff. It was like episode 3 wasn't bad.
Yeah.
Like the like when we say the dynamic between, I don't even, because they really didn't establish a dynamic yet. It was more so
when Loki came out as bisexual.
Yes.
I mean, wasn't he always bisexual technically?
Yeah.
Being a god or whatever.
He fucked the goat, but you know that's neither here nor there.
But hey, shout out to Pandaren. Sales. No offense, I'm just saying Disney's a business. Pride Month. Disney's a business, and businesses in the business of making money. I mean, listen, I love Captain Falcon and Winter Soldier, but that was pandering too, and I liked it. It was good pandering, but I liked it. So yeah, I don't really, you know, shout out to that. But it's like we got some backstory, kind of like where like she didn't know her mom or something, so she taught herself that magic to manipulate people. But like, other than that, like, I'm not saying she's a bad character. Like, this is really her first episode, so I'm gonna give her a chance because there's 3 more episodes to go. So I'm gonna give her a chance. It's just as far as first impressions go. Like, got introduced this episode. How does Cam feel about Sylvie's character? Now, listen, all my comic book niggas, I don't read the comics. I don't know shit. I usually ask Daytrail and Chris or DC about this stuff. But from my point of view, as being a casual nigga who liked Marvel, she wasn't hitting. She wasn't hitting for me. So I didn't really like her like that.
Like, for me...
What did Paul George do?
I don't know. Yeah, hold on.
Oh, they tapped the ball out of the mound.
Then Chris Paul, they just fouled Chris Paul. 7 seconds. But like, episode 3 was, like, I enjoyed it. Probably because I don't really have a problem with Sylvie Loki. That's what I'm just going to call her, Sylvie Loki. It was just, it's funny just seeing the dynamic was funny for me. It's still building. But just see the failures that just happened between them was just hilarious for me. And just the series of events, like, that last scene was just beautiful for me, so that kind of captivated me. But also, just seeing them try to out Loki each other, which what Loki keeps saying, like, but that was interesting for me. But like, in terms of just them trying to figure shit out, was just hilarious, and just how also close Sylvie was to accomplish her mission, and all it did was take Loki to pop up and be like, "Hey, check it out," but. I get where you guys is coming from with y'all critiques, but I genuinely did enjoy episode 3. It was probably the most straightforward episode, if I had to describe it. It's the most straightforward episode of Loki to me. Because it wasn't dialogue heavy, but it was more like kind of a little bit more action driven. So that's probably why it probably appealed to me. But it was still a solid episode to me. DC, you want to add anything?
Yeah, I was going to say, I enjoy Sylvie's character a lot. And I know part of that is the potential of her character, so I'll acknowledge that there wasn't a lot to go upon in this episode, but the little I got, I appreciate, because she's giving off this I was raised by the TVA type vibe, where I've been interacting with them for a while, because if you notice how she talks, Loki is like mischievous, and you know, on the nose type Loki. She kind of goes about things like a militaristic way, because she's always talking about the mission. She's quick to fight.
Yeah, she wants to kill and stuff like that.
Yeah, so you could tell in a conversation where she's like, "Oh, how was my mother?" or "How was our mother?" because she basically implies
trying to live vicariously through Loki, basically.
Live vicariously through him, I guess, but I think more of I want to see how I could have been if the TVA or whatever happened to me didn't happen. And so I just like the comparison of the two. I think it's a good comparison because Loki's kind of full of himself and she seems like she's for a greater cause. It's heavily implying that.
Because you know, they spoiled it. My bad, DC. They spoiled it in the dialogue between Owen Wilson and Loki, when he was asking Loki, like, we're just trying to find out what makes him tick. He was like, you know, most of the time the evil people ain't evil, but the good people are evil.
Yeah, yeah.
The evil people are good.
Yeah, she's definitely a good person. Like, she's getting humanized.
Yeah. Wait, hold on. Come on now. She's a woman in Marvel, bro.
Hey, bro, come on, man. You know that Infinity War scene where Pepper had the suit? And
went back to go get the listen, this isn't me. Listen, I'm not trying to be toxic masculinity.
I'm definitely is.
What happened in Captain Captain America or Falcon and Winter Soldier with old girl's character? What happened with her? Yeah, she was a terrorist who was about to blow shit up, but at the end, when Falcon had his or Captain America had his this ain't her fault, it's y'all fault situation, they wanted her to be a redeemable bad guy. It's the same thing with this one.
She hasn't done anything bad though, from what I've seen. Everybody killed people.
She killed the people that we supposed to be rooting for, I guess. The time variance people.
She hasn't done anything villainous as far as I've seen. Because the TVA people, they don't care about, I forgot what episode it was, but they was doing something. And they said there's people around. And they didn't care. Like, the way the TVA is being set up as the villains. Like,
yeah.
So.
But like, she is a counterpart of a villain. Of Loki.
I mean, is Loki really a villain at this point?
The Loki is popular with the female demographic. So in order to capture the eye candy, you've seen Loki with his shirt off, they're going to make him good. It's the same instance with, she is a prominent female character in Marvel. They're not going to make her look bad. And if they do make her look bad, she's going to be redeemable.
I'm fine with that. I don't have an issue. I like the potential where her character is going to be. I hope she kind of stays because it adds a... I mean, like, some people said that Sylvie, I don't know much about the Sylvie character, but they said she's like a offshoot of Enchantress or whatever. So it's good to have more sorcery characters that aren't just Doctor Strange based. Like, there's other, but I'm just interested in what she could bring to the table in Marvel. So I enjoyed her character and what she could do. And I think the episode was really good in terms of, it wasn't really her introductory episode. I think it was more characterization on Loki. Because he had the little crazy number he was singing in Nordic, whatever that shit was. And then he was talking about how his mother taught him magic. Like, you're getting more of the relationship, because in the Thor movies, you don't really get much of him and his mom. You
really don't, no.
If not at all, so.
Oh, because those movies sucked.
And that's true. That's true. But it's good to hear more dialogue on that situation, characterizing. Because the only connection he had in the movies was just Thor. So it's good to see more.
Where do y'all see Loki go from here?
I have an idea.
Becomes a detective. Loki, ace detective.
I agree. I think that's what he's going to do. Like, he's just going to pop in. Like, you know how, like...
You become a time variant?
I think that's what they're going to use him for. He's going to pop in whenever Sun's going at
him. He's not going to beat them.
Yeah.
There's three episodes left.
Dang.
There's six episodes. There's three episodes left, and the fourth episode, the last episode just ended with a moon exploding. They're not finna pull up.
There's people that have theories that Kang's gonna show up. I'm like, y'all didn't learn y'all lesson from the last.
The only reason why people think Kang is popping up is because the head of the TVA, the black girl, light-skinned black girl, I forgot her name. That's supposed to be his girlfriend or something like that in the comics.
They have some type of relationship. Kang's wife or something.
I must be thinking of the wrong Kang. Of the nigga from Spider-Man.
The Kang the Conqueror.
Kraven.
I thought he was talking about Kraven. I don't know who Kang is, so
man. Kang the Conqueror, that's a real nigga. Like that, like this version of that nigga.
Comic book. Come on, this is MCU. Don't get your hopes up.
This game over. Finally,
they got a good actor.
Like the Mandarin on Iron Man 3.
Oh my god!
The Mandarin about to get a huge redeeming in Shang-Chi though. At least.
Oh, that Shang-Chi trailer. I like.
Oh,
that.
Oh yeah, that was fire,
bro. That nigga
That was my nigga Wang though. That was Wang fighting Abomination.
Oh, from
yeah, from Doctor Strange. Yeah, oh, that was him fighting. Yeah, that was him fighting Abomination. G,
that's mad funny, bro. Well, that man that's said, mad "Look." But shout out to him though. I'm glad.
Niggas about to get baited. It is what it is.
Yeah, that's what we learned from.
Here's the thing. That we just all need to realize is that there's this thing that Loki's attached to called Disney Plus.
Yep.
All they're trying to do is ride out your Disney Plus subscription until they can keep getting that $7 a month. So all of this, so they when they start doing those premiere movies that cost $30 on top of your Disney Plus subscription, it's going to be, Black Widow. You saw Loki. Loki is just a huge masturbation until Doctor Strange or whatever movie where you can actually experience the orgasm. That's all this is. This Loki stuff is just a huge teasing jerk off fest. Because we not finna get no payoffs. We just gonna get setups.
That's the purpose of these movies. I mean these series. So it is what it is. We're gonna cut news out. Staying there entirely. Well, no, we've actually breezed through most of these.
Well, I mean, we could low-key save one of them for a clown.
Yeah.
The first one we could save. That's a clown.
That's a clown. So the rest of these are like pretty much quick news. So, Vinland Saga, there's an announcement for Vinland Saga next month. So, it could possibly be the return of the anime, hopefully. Or maybe
that
a movie.
I was about to say 2023. We gonna all forget again.
I hope not. It depends. Amazon does a decent job with the anime timing, though. So we'll see. But either way, be on the lookout for a Vinland Saga announcement next month. Cyberpunk is back on PlayStation Store. You know the vibes when it comes to that.
They told you, niggas.
They told you, do not play that shit on the base PS4. Do not play it. Not play this game on base PS4. We bringing it back. But do not play this on base PS4.
From an unbiased source in the parties, he has told me that it runs way better on right now than it did previously. But he did say the initial drought of the game basically sucked him out of it. So him not being able to, and I think his save file got corrupted. So him not being, he got it back. I think I don't know one of the two, but he haven't playing it. But the initial like drought of not, you know, having to wait this big old gap for, because like y'all thought the shit, Karen, you thought the shit was broke with me and you played it. Try when they was going through patch hell, bro.
Oh, I know. Every patch they were saying that some shit was changing. I'm like, man, that shit is going off my system, G.
But you know, money. Exactly. I can't wait till 3 years from now when they brought out the earnings report and they made so much fucking money, bro. I can't fucking wait.
Or when we get to think pieces 3 years later about how Cyberpunk was one of the greatest games of all times. Because back then it'll actually be 2 years
later.
Yeah, it'll actually be an actual game.
Exactly.
I'm still waiting for the next gen version though. That's why I'm planning on playing
is when the next gen version come out. Like I'll finish it, but
if it comes out.
Yeah, that's a big if. So
I think Witcher 4. They go announce Witcher 4. Please come back. Please love us again.
There's a thing called WitcherCon that's coming up. We might just do Witcher 4. Here.
It's like, please love us. Witcher 4 is dropping.
Yo, G, that is that PR stunt, G. That's a PR stunt, G. Fall for it if you want. That's a PR stunt.
I actually can't wait because the Witcher show coming back, bro. And I love that freaking show.
Yeah, I did too.
I can't wait, man.
But moving on, and last piece of news. Y'all know the vibes. If they're going to keep doing a countdown. So are we.
Oh, yes, yes.
So, Daytrip, pump the music out. Because I'm not getting copyright strict.
Talk it out.
Hold on. I got y'all. Hold on.
Okay.
I got y'all.
Because with that being said, G, it has been.
I got a speaker, Cam. Hold on. I got a speaker, bro.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Play
so,
play
with
stuff.
That being said, G, with that being said.
Wait, hold on. One second.
930 plus days of no Hunter X Hunter. And all I gotta say is to Togashi.
See a doctor! See a doctor!
see Dr. G.
Wait, hold on, Daytrail. Hold on, pause it real quick. Hold on, I got y'all. Run real quick. I'm going to go ahead.
Hold go on. See a Dr. G.
Hold on.
Please see a Dr. G. Yeah.
One second. One add image.
Okay.
All right, play it. Right,
there we go. We get all the way negative in here, G.
Now I want a could fall into the sky. Do you think time would pass me by?
930 days. Where you at, nigga?
Hey, when I see you, I'ma push your shit back, boy. I try to get the spin through your set. We don't fight, boy. 12 paramedics couldn't save your fucking life, boy. Rod can't dead and he never coming back, boy. We gon' treat this bitch like a match, how we strike. Let his ass in the street, this the end of your life. Let us stay your ass, see a flashlight and it's max, bro. These niggas tall as hell, all these niggas, they just act hard. I'ma shoot this bitch when I motherfucking see you. I don't go nowhere without my motherfucking heat, cool. Smoking on Lil Peter, I was smoking Trey D2. Free my nigga Max till they motherfucking free you. Knock a nigga out, boy, you could get your ass beat too. Lil' hoe, you trippin', baby girl, I don't need you. I walk 1,000 miles and I still don't wanna see you. I got the whole city dead, these niggas know what we do. Who I smoke, baby, who I smoke,
bone.
Who I smoke, the nine, now I wonder.
All right, cut it. All right, cut it, G. So, yeah, that's the update, G. 930 days and still no Hunter X, Hunter G.
Hey, listen, hold on, because we this has been a long time coming. Let me get this off. Let me get this off right here.
It's been a long time. We just did it like a month ago.
No. Hold on.
Oh, this is a cam literally going across the.
I'm gonna be worldly with this shit. Hold on. I'm on top of the world. Listen. To all you Hunter fans, I'm not talking about you, DC. I'm not talking about you, Chris. I'm talking about you. This shit is word of God. I'm talking about worse than One Piece fan base. When I say this to honest to God, no slight to you, Togashi, do your thing, you know what I'm saying? Yu Yu Hakusho, Dark Tournament, you know, one of the best anime endings of all time, you know what I'm saying? Fuck Hunter Hunter. I don't want niggas to tell me shit about watching or reading Hunter. I'm not doing it, nigga. I'm not. I don't care about the fucking clown pedophile nigga. I don't care about his bubblegum powers. I don't care about going turning into some grown ass man with a long ass fucking hair. I don't care about that little bitch nigga, lightning killer nigga. I don't care about that cell knockoff Miriam. I don't care about none of these niggas, boys, on head top. I'm smoking on a pack, bro. Why? It's been 930 days. So gosh, you don't care about them niggas, G. You know what he care about? He care about nigga from Dragon Quest 11 that look like future Trunks. You know what he care about? He care about Dragon Quest 12 just got announced. It's supposed to be a darker game. That's what he care about. He don't care. Y'all care so much about this series, and this nigga is collecting Sailor Moon checks. He don't care about your series, bro. Stop capping for this man. Stop capping for this series, dog. It's over. And I do this. I'll even do y'all this. When Hunter Hunter actually eventually continues on, I might watch it. But I'm not going to watch it until the hiatus period of him right now. So however long this hiatus is, when Hunter Hunter, if it ever gets completed, I might check the series out. And when it ends, so say for instance, this man has 1,500 plus days. I will not check Hunter Hunter out for 1,500 days. I'm gonna be on my hiatus like him. That's all I gotta say. It's because when I don't know, it's something about Hunter Hunter fans that rubs me the wrong way. I don't know if it's just me, but whenever niggas talk about this series, I'm just like, bro, even your author don't care about this series, G. What you capping for? Play Dragon Quest like he does and shut up. That's all I got to say, bro. It's on our head talk, G. All
right, 930 days. DC, how do you feel?
I don't give a fuck what you just said. I'm going to still watch that shit. I'm going to still, you know, I hear a lot of, no, I'm not talking about y'all. But I've been seeing a lot of Hunter Hunter hate. I'm not going to hop on that bandwagon. So fuck it. I'm waiting like everybody else.
We got bitches! You know, common knowledge that Hunter Hunter scares the hoes.
It is really don't, though.
Now, surprisingly, I'm gonna keep it G real.
It don't.
A lot of girls do love Hunter Hunter G. No, I don't know.
Because
which one brings more hoes, Naruto Hunter X Hunter?
Now, I will say this. No, from recent experience, more bad bitches rock with Naruto, but like I met some decent chicks that do like Hunter Hunter. I won't say refrigerators. No, not refrigerators.
I'm gonna say a lot of females like Hunter Hunter because of the double standard stuff. They like that, you know, they like Killua, they like Gon, you know what I'm saying?
They like the androgynistic dude.
They like the keyword kids.
Oh, they like the shipping?
No. They like the kids.
Oh.
Let's put it like that.
Are you OD now?
Bro? All right, man. So on that note, we got summer animated.
I'm definitely not.
No, you're not lying, but Cam.
Definitely not.
There's a lot of rule 64 or whatever that is about ratchets.
It is a fucking dumb. This isn't even me doing a hot take. It's just an anime thing, period. It is a huge double standard between when boys is out here, when grown men is out here watching these shows, lusting after these little chicks versus when a woman does it. It is a huge fucking double standard.
Not lying.
You do not have to look hard for that shit.
You really don't. They're in our Twitter follows.
You have grown women lusting after little boys in anime, but we allow it because they're girls. But then when a dude does it, it's like cast fucking stones at him. Huge double standard.
Cam's not lying.
I know we joking here on the podcast. If this nigga got like fucking tuberculosis or something, bro, get better.
Please. No, he
a doctor, dog. Like, consult your wife.
We joke. This man probably don't even give a fuck about anime because that shit not important.
Listen, Dragon Quest XI is a great game.
Does he really like Dragon Quest? Or this is a joke.
No, he plays Dragon Quest. Like, I'm not making a meme out of it. You can look it up. I think he said he put like hundreds of hours into Dragon Quest XI.
Yeah, G.
It
all makes sense now.
Dragon Quest XI is a great game.
Play Dragon Quest. I have played it. That game has the longest fucking end game I have ever seen in my fucking life, bro.
That's why it's taking him so long to write a chapter. He's just trying to explore all of it.
He's trying to get to level 99, the OG.
Yeah. He don't want to do the metal slime and farm trick. He wants to genuinely experience Dragon Quest. Yeah, and maybe, hey, I wouldn't be surprised if when Hunter Hunter comes back, y'all see a lot of Dragon Quest references in there.
So you pretty much saying it's gonna look like Toriyama vibes in there.
Yeah, exactly, bro. He go hit up Toriyama. Hey, maybe. We saying that he might give it to his wife, but if he hit up Toriyama and go like, hey, I fuck with Dragon Quest, you draw my series. I wanted you to draw the rest of my series.
Niggas gonna be mad as hell.
I wanna see it so bad. All the Hunter Hunter niggas going like, fuck Dragon Ball. Hunter Hunter has the best fucking story ever. And now it's like, hey, bro, it's being drawn by the nigga who made Dragon Ball.
I finally said today, I met my father. Hi, I'm Goku.
Yo, that is still one of the funniest TikTok memes right now, G. Hey, I'm Goku.
Yeah, that shit is hilarious.
All right, so let's go ahead and move on. We're going to get ready to wrap this episode up. But summer anime was probably going to start dropping as early as this week. But next week, probably for the bulk of everything. So,
the biggest one.
What did they say is coming out?
The biggest one. Let me skip out the. Let me just go.
Is My Hero continuing on into the summer?
My Hero, Tokyo Revengers, are the big heavy hitters. Shaman King, but we're not seeing that to August.
I don't care about that show anymore.
All right, either. Cool. Let me go to this app because I know this does a better job just breaking down everything.
But the,
I hate that you said the big hitters is My Hero and Shami. I mean,
Tokyo. It's My Hero, Tokyo Revengers. That means like this season might be low key trash.
It low key is. The Kimmy G-Rail low key is. It low key is. I don't know, bro. I'm giving it G-Rail low key is. So
kind of garbage, G.
But outside of those two, and of course, One Piece and shit, that time I got reincarnated as Slime Part 2, that's big.
That's on a season 3, right?
Season 2, but it's part 2 of season 2. They took a ReZero type break, you know, so they skipped a season. So this season is pretty ass. I'm just going to keep it G-Rail, but this is the hype shit. So so get ready to be highly disappointed. So the ongoing stuff is like I said, I already mentioned Tokyo Revengers, My Hero, which I will watch My Hero because we're going to Villain Academia. So,
is it over?
That bullshit ass.
Yeah, the 1A versus 1B stuff over? Yeah,
that's done. So, I'm actually going to watch My Hero now.
They said they're skipping, rearranging My Villain.
If they fucking rearrange shit,
I heard they rearranged it.
If they do it, then I'm done. Well, I'm already done, but I'm done. Because all I want to see is Shigaraki level the city. That's the only moment that I'm
going to tune in. I think they're rearranging when they went to the Endeavor internship.
They're doing that first, and then they're doing... Are they doing that? Did they show that preview in one of the
episodes? The episode they dropped recently. This week was Endeavor related, but I don't know how they're doing it. So we'll see. They might actually combine the shit.
They might combine it if they do that.
Refresh my memory, bro.
Deku.
Oh shit! No, it's not Endeavor. It's Sizzle. Our bad.
There we go. Okay. Sizzle.
Is this the Sizzle we found out he's even more of a crappy father, but just sad?
No. That's after. No. That's after when my villain.
Things get nuked.
That's the Sizzle stuff happens after, Shigaraki pulls up.
You get him talking to his other son because his other son was on his ass.
He's talking about like the backstory. We get that after.
Yeah,
like,
that's much Shigaraki much later. We're probably ain't getting that to next year. We ain't getting that to like next year.
So. It's like when they all work with Endeavor and they learn how
it's
to.
It's the top. It's the top three that work with Endeavor.
Okay, yeah. But who they fighting? I'm sorry to be that.
They really wasn't doing shit because that was more of the backstory compared to what the... No, Daytra, you have to listen. It was more... The villains was more on the forefront while they just occasionally went back to the
That shit I skipped!
What's the point of... It was like Endeavor teaching them how to be better heroes and how to control their powers. Like, telling Bakugo how to, like, control his powers better. Todoroki how to control his powers better with all that stuff.
Nigga who been number two his whole entire life until he got fucking cancer. Until the number one got fucking All Might cancer, whatever the fuck you want to call it. Tell me I'm going to teach you how to be a better hero. I'm hanging up my cape. Nigga, I meant to.
You say that like All Might did a better job.
Hey, bro, the city was safe when All Might was
around. Oh, God. It was. That's so true. We, even as much crap as we talk about how All Might was a failure when it comes to it comes to One For All, he was a hero.
But he's smart.
He did do a decent job.
That's my cousin. Mm-hmm. Why are you here? Go get your flight.
Hey, he was gonna hear. He's a ball game.
Hey, what's good, nigga?
The casino, what, bro? I'm gonna get us decent.
Hey, you know what I'm saying? Your boy out here.
Yo, that nigga gonna hit the casino up and G end up in a Russian pack.
If a certain Russian by the name of Ivan come up to you and say, "I need you to dodge this." Right. Don't even.
If he walks up to say, I need you to. Do you know Detra Bogan? Does he live in this area?
Do you put transit on your bus fare? Or do you?
I just put it like fares. I go here. I'm gonna get you one.
We taking the bus tomorrow. Right.
You go somewhere tomorrow?
Yeah. I don't know why I'm talking about this on the podcast. Yeah.
He definitely do. I heard about that pull up, the legendary pull up. That pull up is a legend.
Yeah. Like,
That's what the Russian dude was for. Is the data of Bulgaria. I have a message.
Yo, Russians to pull up on all of us, G. Yo, that'd be scary.
You get the Russian mob.
Yo, Pastor High is Russians to pull up on us and come back to church, G. That's nasty.
He's like, he worked wrong. He was wrong.
DC go ahead and knock at his door, too. He's like, wait, what?
I'm like, nigga, it's Aurora. But, all right, but let's get back to it. So, anyway, the ongoing shit. My Hero, One Piece, of course, Tokyo Revengers. To Eternity, which I heard is pretty decent, but I didn't even bother watching it.
Hunter Hunter.
Ongoingly on hiatus.
It's ongoing, technically.
You know, it hasn't had its end date yet, you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
It's TBA.
Welcome to Demon School. That's ongoing. Boruto's ongoing, unfortunately. And Shaman King. So those are the, and Eden Zero's ongoing.
It sound like I'm being watching another
bro,
show.
Bro, I'm saying it sound like I'm really finna be able to watch all three seasons of Ice Shield 21.
Exactly. Like, don't be surprised. I'm just gonna say this because I already looked. A lot of this shit in this season is gonna make me find some deep cuts elsewhere. That's all I'm gonna say.
So, I got so many shows I want to catch up on, bro. It's
what's the original shit that's coming out?
All right, so the original shit. So let's go ahead and start with how a realist hero rebuilt the kingdom.
Is this an isekai?
Yes.
Skip.
That name so ass.
It's like isekais, they like to make these stupid ass names because it's like they're self-aware now. They know that like the name sells. So like, because you know how the anime community is full of a bunch of try-hard memers, which I call is like people who try too hard to make a meme funny, but it turns out to not be funny. So they'll take that title and they'll go like, oh, this is one of the best isekais I watched. Think piece shit, right? When it's really not.
Yeah, so that. So that's the first isekai. Then we have Girlfriend, which is a comedy romance slice of life.
Okay. All right.
So
okay,
here
okay.
we go. Description. The protagonist, Naya, is a first year in high school. He asks Naya, that's a woman girl name.
Yeah, okay. He has a chick's name. Oh, yeah. 2021. Can't judge. 2021. Come on. All right. Now.
So he asks Saki, a girl he has been in love with, and she agrees to be his girlfriend. He's on cloud nine, but then a beautiful girl named Nagisa comes up to Naya one day and tells him that she wants to go out with him. Naya feels himself wavering because Nagisa is such a good girl. He comes to a decision. A new kind of rom-com from an unexpected decision is about to begin.
So we got fuck out of here. Skip next.
That nigga got hoes.
Nah, bro. Bro, that is so generic. It is so cliche. I don't know why he's saying it's a new.
I'm just reading the summary.
I took the first episode out, but niggas was saying that what's that fucking show called? The rom-com where the childhood girl went. That shit was ass. I dropped that
first episode, so I already knew that shit was ass.
So I'm just saying, like, if I get the same vibes, drop.
Yeah. So next is The Detective Is Already Dead, which is a comedy drama mystery. When the story begins, about his hero, what's his name? I swear I hate pronouncing these names. Kimihiko has always been a magnet for trouble and intrigue for as long as he can remember. He's been stumbling across murder scenes, receiving mysterious attached cases to transport. When he meets Siesta, a brilliant detective fighting a secret war against an organization, he couldn't resist the call to become her assistant and join on her epic journey. Until a year ago, that is now he's returned to life that is normal and tepid by comparison. So, yeah.
So he's retired and he goes back into the forest, basically?
That's what it sounds like.
Yep. Next.
All right. Drugstore in Another World, The Slow Life of a Cheat Pharmacist. This is the isekai.
Wait, what the fuck? What's the name of that show?
Drugstore in Another World.
The Slow Life of a Cheat Pharmacist.
You selling perk 30s.
Read the description. Read the description.
You want me to read the description? Because I did not want to, but all right. Reggie Kirio was a corporate wage slave. Okay.
Oh, here you go. Yep.
Yep. Okay. Who did nothing but work all day, every day. On a typical day, walked to work. He suddenly found himself in the forest of another world. Okay, shout out to Truck Coon. Oh, this must be an isekai reincarnation people keep talking about. Self-aware. That's what we're self-aware. So,
but it's not. But it's not. But it doesn't have the appeal of the Fast and Furious season. Not a good self-aware.
It's the Japanese appeal. So, you know, the two skills he has are appraise and drug discovery. Those don't sound too impressive or whatever, except these turn out to be particularly overpowered skills. He's able to produce the healing medicines that were sorely lacking in the world, one after another, leading to a block. Oh my God.
Skip this. All right, I'm you skip this, bro. I don't want to hear the rest of this shit.
Right. That's the Sensu Bean origin, bro. We getting the origin story.
Oh boy, that's some ass.
This is a very isekai heavy one, but here's another one. Remake Our Life, which is a comedy, and based off the picture, okay, it has grown women with titties. So,
all right,
and dude is actually grown. It says so. Hashiba,
you like tits?
Hey, Hashiba Kayuya is a 28-year-old game developer with his own company going bankrupt. And him losing his job, he returns to his hometown looking at the success of his creators of his age. He finds himself regretting his life decision as he lays distressed on his bed. But then he opens his eyes and he finds that he has traveled 10 years back to the time before he entered college. Will he make things right? Oh,
it's one of those. It's funny, though, because that's usually the synopsis of a hentai.
It is plot. It's plot as in titties on this picture, letting you know, like, hey, so, yeah. But it's just comedy.
Speaking of plot, you know, back to the Sensu Beam story, that's also going to show the origins of how Yajirobe and Kieran met.
Ooh.
And they became the first.
Maybe the Reggie dude, maybe he is Yajirobe.
You know, the only reason Yajirobe got fat because he was fucking a fucking bunny the whole entire time. So he just got fat throughout this whole entire exchange. I'm sorry. I've been holding in them Yajirobe's fucking foreign jokes for like 6 years. They have to go.
Like Yamcha and the cat?
Yamcha definitely was fucking Pwar. He told Pwar, I need you to
turn to Bulma.
Yeah, right. You gotta hold that.
You said you approve of that.
I said he got to hold that. Hold.
I'm like, hey,
hold that. So anyway, like I said, it's a lot of ass, but this is probably the last one that's kind of like elevated. And this is filth. And Cam, you just talked about double standards. So, Mother of the Goddess Dormitory. What? Nagumi Kushi is a 12-year-old boy. 12-year-old boy.
All right.
Who was abandoned by his father after the house caught on fire, leaving him to roam the streets penniless. Then one day, a girl named Minerva, who finds him lying on the sidewalk, takes him to a women's college dormitory, 12 years old, one known for housing troublesome residents, and asks him to be their dorm mother. Surrounded by older women, forced to deal with their idiosyncrasies, Kushi starts his somewhat etchy life.
What? That sounds like that one show. I forgot what it was called, but it's like this little boy who gets taken care of by this one chick, and she's like his like tutor. And like she has like a bunch of other chicks who show up, but like he's like in middle school, but like it's like she's a grown woman. But she like teases him, and it's like etchy in there too. I don't understand that. I think it's even, because I don't think, flip the script. Has there ever been an anime where there was a young, like noticeably young? I'm talking about like not like a young girl with big boobs or anything like that. I'm talking about like a child. Like a child girl, and she is surrounded by these adult men and they are lusting after her and she's involved in a bunch of like sort of, because you know you're going to get the typical edgy scenes in that show where it's like tits against him, things that like he's touching their tits, his face is in between the tits and stuff like that. Is there an anime where it's a reverse, where it's like it's a small girl surrounded by a bunch of older dudes, and like instead of tit rubbing, it's dick rubbing?
Now, yes, there's a couple. Now, I'm gonna need you to pull up on your computer.
Not hentai. I'm talking about anime. I'm talking about actual anime. Is there an actual anime in which there's that scenario, that type of scenario, bro, but it's reversed?
If I turn on an anime and I go in there and it's a chick going like this with nothing but meat and pants going like that.
Yeah, a young child. Yeah, a young girl. And it's a bunch of dudes surrounding them. But I'm just saying, like, let's talk about it.
Ain't no money in game banging unless you're trying to pull up an incognito tab.
Yeah, no, that's not. I'm saying, like, there's a lot of these animes in which is like the Shota, I think that's what they call them. Shota boy with like grown ass woman with big tits. And when people talk about this anime, they're gonna probably call it quirky or funny, or if you ignore the ecchi scenes, there's a deep story behind it, or blah 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 blah. But I never really see the reverse of that. Like, if you can do it with boys, why don't you do it with girls? It's money in there. Yeah, some people will watch it.
You know, technically that shit happened with Sailor Moon with just one nigga. He was like 42.
He's not lying, but that, god damn.
But, you know, I don't know. Shit, I'm going to keep it bucked. If I see shit, I know it is me. I'm different. But if I see this shit, I'll be one of them niggas like, hey, man, let's go back to the old-fashioned anime with tournament arts and rivals.
Oh, God.
Not this.
A 12-year-old boy seeing tits for the first time.
You mean before we start actually dwelling to other anime. That's what happened. He's just like, we get tired of shonen. And dwell on, like, the fuck?
So, my R&B hands, bro.
But yeah, so this anime season is really fucking bad. So then again,
it's a perfect time to catch up on some shows.
Catch up on some shit.
Hey, I'm telling you, it is,
like, low key for me, I gotta catch up on Digimon. Everybody been saying Digimon has been heat.
I gotta watch that Dragon Quest show too. If it's
the there's a Dragon Quest show, and also Scarlet Nexus got an anime as well. So
yeah.
I gotta go. I try not to watch adaptations of video fucking
games. Yeah, I don't normally watch those. I watched Persona's anime. Persona 5's anime was fire. I actually enjoyed it.
Yeah, them first few episodes are fucking brutal. Hey. Them bitches brutal.
Four was better.
Them bitches brutal.
But yeah, so this season's pretty bad, but I will give stuff an open one or two episode watch. And move on from there.
Yeah, I'll check out that girlfriend show.
Yeah, I'll check that show out. That's
I'm gonna be on the search for what Cam asked for. Getting fucking
little girl who's surrounded by a bunch of grown men.
That's not a hint. For the
listeners and viewers, this is a serious question. If you can find that, because I don't see it, so I just want to know if there's such a show out there, and if it is a show. Is it held up to the same quirky standard as a lot of these other shows with little boys surrounded by grown women is?
And that's just make a cash incentive, because I'm going to clip this specific part out. If you guys find said anime and it's not a hentai, I'll cash app you $5.
If you find it. Big bucks.
Fuck, I look like giving these niggas any bigger money. We don't got major money.
Hey, you can use that $5 to pre-order Durag Season.
Exactly. See? There you go. But yeah, if you can find that, we will give you I will cash app you $5 out of my pocket. $5 ain't gonna hurt me that badly. But
and I'll even check the show out. I'll even watch like the first couple episodes to see what it's about.
Ooh, I just thought of a content idea if it turns out to work out that way. I just thought of a fun content. But anyway,
we can have a YouTube series, Did Day Trail Fall Asleep by watching this show? Watching this shit falling asleep.
But yeah, so this is a very mid season, just a prime example, because I'm looking at my anime list.
All the animals. I be going on the fucking Funimation and the Crunchyroll. All I see is queued up shit. I'm like, Chris,
it's a lot of shit that's queued up that I don't watch.
These bitches be on episode 7, 9, 8. I'm like, damn, nigga. This shit ain't that good. Anime ain't that fucking good, bro.
You know, sometimes I probably fall asleep.
Okay.
They do autoplay. Remember, they do autoplay. Exactly.
I'm like some shit I just probably, like, I was watching and I'd be like, I go to sleep, G. Like, it's open. It's like, okay. Then I look at him like, I hear the intro song. Like, oh, shit. My fault.
Or you know what? Take this anime season, because I know some people can't balance, like, nerd stuff. So, like, anime or playing video games. Take this anime season. Stop watching anime. Play some video games.
Exactly. That, too.
Maybe some games you want to catch up on.
Yeah, real quick. Exactly. This boss, this level 5 boss in this game, is this a it supposed to kill me boss, or is this a I got to beat
him? No, you got to beat him.
But yeah, so with all that being said, catch up on some shit, play some games, try to watch this shit. It's up to you. The choice is yours. I have options, at least.
Just don't expect a lot of coverage from us, to be honest.
Exactly, because I'm already not feeling that confident right now. I'm just keeping it G fucking real. I'm not feeling that confident. So it is what it is. We do got fucking clowns, though. So let's go ahead and move on.
The universal clown first. The universal clown.
Yeah, let's do the universal clown. So our universal clown. So some dumbass in Japan, and this, let's just remember, I watched Higehiro from start to finish this anime season. So we already have been vocal on this podcast by saying, if you so choose to take in a runaway, it is still kidnapping and you can go to jail. So this dumbass, he's a lawyer, which makes it even worse. You live in Japan where they don't play.
They do not play about kid. Child kidnapping.
29 years old.
Play about that shit.
A lawyer. You should know better. You so chose to take in this child and you end up going to jail. Hold that fucking analogy. Cherish it. Love it. Because you should know better.
Go ahead, Ken. There's a key difference between anime and real life. A very key difference between the two. I can't, as much as I want my hair that's up right now to turn yellow and my eyes to glow green, unless God says, hey, I'm going to give you this W for this one time, I'm going to let you live your dream. Not happening, bro. As much as I wanted to, it won't happen. As much as I want to phase through this window and fly out, got to remember some things. It's real life. So just because Higehiro, just because dude got away with it, does not mean that you're going to have a high school Japanese girl at your doorstep going like, hey, can I come with you and want to fuck you at every step of the way? I know you wanted that. You ain't getting it. You know what you are getting, though? Quality jail time. And I hope you got a decent-looking build, because people get lonely there.
Mm-hmm.
Things happen when people lonely.
Exactly. So even more detail on this, because I found an article. So Takahara Komiya, a 29-year-old lawyer, contacted the high school girl via social media after she posted, I want you to
lawyer.
Stay from home. I will be happy if you considered me as an option to stay when you ran away from home. Predator vibes, G.
Keep in mind, he's a lawyer.
He's a fucking lawyer. So he should know better. The Japanese police also stated that the student's mother reported the alleged kidnapping after the girl didn't arrive home on the day she ran away. After a while, the police found the student at Kamiya's place and arrested him. So she actually did will proceed to go to that nigga house. And then after that, he admitted to the charges and authorities threw that nigga in jail. So,
dumbass.
So pretty much this man is full-fledged clown. Just remember, there's a difference between reality and fantasy. And even in the fantasy that is Higehiro, that man knew at least he can go to jail, but at least
that man is an actual, the man in the anime is a kidnapper.
He's
it's
a
just
kidnapper.
His anime.
He's a kidnapper. He's a criminal. It's just he didn't go to jail. But this fool is a full-fledged lawyer who should know the law better than anybody else. And if I think it's one thing, look, one thing about Japanese culture I've learned whether it's through cam, anime, or playing Judgment, Japanese don't play about shit when it comes to crimes.
So crime,
they want to lock you up.
They do not play. Bro, you could take a fucking melon bun of bread from a store and you could get arrested for up to like 2 years, dog. They don't play about that shit.
They don't play.
They don't. And child kidnapping especially. Like, there's a lot of crimes in the U.S. that are very, that you get like more, that's more like, oh shit, you done fucked up. Kidnapping, child kidnapping in Japan is a very, oh shit, you done fucked up type of offense that you could commit. And your goofy ass did it, bro. This nigga watched episode one and was like, "Oh, I'm a be Hige hero. I'm a live my fantasy. Let's go."
That nigga saw Redo Hiller. He was like, "Bro, that's me."
Shit. Wow. Damn.
So I got an idea, future. For actually a video on the YouTube channel. We're gonna do a drinking game on the season two of Tokyo Avengers. DC gonna be there too. He got a binge watching. And every time this nigga cry,
we are going to be drunk as fuck, bro. You wanna know how bad it he cry? The fucking theme song of the show is called Cry Baby.
Hey, that thing is so fucking
fire. And it's fire. It is fire. Absolute fuego. But the theme song is called Cry Baby.
Tokyo Avengers does has the best opener of this season, though.
By far, has the best opener.
It's funny as hell. I was watching Tokyo Avengers. Soon as shit go off, I'm in that bitch like this.
I'm like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And then as soon as the actual talk starts, I'm just like,
as soon as my man's go, and then he's just like, energy goes back down. But yeah, so that's the universal clown. Do I have a personal clown? I feel like I did. A lot of people blew me. I'm just going to give my, I can't think of a person right now, so one of y'all want to go ahead, because it was somebody I just wanted outright.
Big clowns to the referees and the National Basketball Association.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
Dog.
Oh, yeah, for that.
Games in this playoffs, the last 30 seconds, I think, was 30 minutes.
Yes.
In real time. Imagine you watching just 30. The referees put themselves in the game so much in the final second, bro. It's not even. It's hell, G. Hell to watch. Just the last minute we watch. We watched 10 free throws in the last minute. Like, this is. And then, you know, I hate players when they twerk for fouls. But, you know, they just twerking on the floor and shit like that for fouls. And it's getting bad out here, dog. Like, just play the ball. Just play the game.
Do you still hold the sentiment that you like this playoff? Like you were saying in the 3-7
game? I love everything, but the last 2 minutes is so unbearable. It's kind of like when you're watching episode 18 and all they're doing is cuts to the main fight. And then as soon as episode 18 main fight happened, they cut it off. Because God damn it, you gotta wait till 19, you gotta wait till episode 19 to get the real nigga shit. Like, it's so fucking bad, bro. But I love the playoffs. I think the fact that we're probably going to see fucking Phoenix Suns versus Atlanta or Milwaukee is fucking fire.
It's Kardashian curse is being broken.
But, you know, sorry for all that sports talk. I knew a couple of niggas that was listening to this just threw up. I apologize. But I fucking hate referees in every sport known to me. I'm not about to drink this shit. I don't think I am.
It's a rock.
Now I remember my clown. Thanks for, wrestling community. Yeah, I know we're going back to the little threes from the ring, but gee, wrestling community for getting that black woman fired because, gee, y'all blew out of proportion the fact that she didn't know shit about wrestling. But at the same time, she's a black woman. So I'm a cap and cape at the same time. But there is a lot of wrestling writers who enter in not knowing shit about wrestling. I used to be on wrestling message boards when I was younger. I hate myself for that. But I learned a lot back then. They used to hire soap opera writers to write these shits. It is a fake show, my nigga. It is scripted. Who cares how that the fact that she don't know who Bobby Lashley is, but she's working with him, and that storyline is decent, and y'all fucked it up. So literally, fuck y'all. But also, I do kind of clown her because you shouldn't have went on a podcast saying what she did. That don't help. But if nobody bothered to listen to that podcast, you would have been straight. And also, wrestling community, you could have left that shit alone.
It was this fuck nigga named like Bugsby or something on Twitter who pointed out the podcast because the podcast nigga ain't had no problem with it. One, is Shorty kind of stupid for saying she don't even know who the fuck the champion name is? Yeah, you was on that Amber Juice. But for you Bugsby ass nigga who's saying you should know wrestling before you write fucking wrestling, dog, wrestling is fucking a kid show. I want to get this shit straight through these niggas' head. Anything that say TV-14 is a fucking kid show. It just means you got to ask your mom before you fucking watch it.
It's realistic shonen. That's all you get.
Man, bro. So besides that, it was this nigga named Busby. So his bitch ass stopping a black woman from getting a job. He black himself. Also, they brought this nigga tweets up. Here's one of them niggas that said, are y'all going to blame the cops after we find out what he did in the past? Fuck that nigga, bro. Everything he's standing on.
So he like a gatekeeping ass nigga?
I hope his grandma fucking fall down a flight of stairs. Like, fuck that nigga, bro. And I hope you wake up and your alarm clock can go off so you late for work and they fire your bitch ass, nigga. Fuck you. In every which way and form, bro.
DC, you got a clown?
Hell no.
Oh, I got a...
DC just on Cloud 9 because of all the Zorro and One Piece shit, man.
I'm in that fucking Discord right now.
I got a goat. I don't have a clown. No. I do have a clown. I don't know the full story, but I did hear something about like the black woman, the track runner, black woman.
This bullshit right here.
No. Oh, dang.
This bullshit right here.
It totally really did that. Hey. Well, I guess that's DC's clown, totally.
Exactly. And there we go. It's totally.
But the black, I don't know if y'all know it, but the story, I think they stopped the black woman who's like really fast, that they're not allowing her to go into the Olympics for some reason.
Wait, what?
Wait, I don't know the full story. I forgot, but like the story that happened that popped up, it was the black woman, she became like one of the fastest female runners in the world. Like she's like Usain Bolt female. I don't know, but I heard something that like she's not allowed. Something about like her testosterones or something that they're not.
Oh, that's a different one. I know what you're talking about. Yeah, I briefly skimmed through.
They're not allowing her to run in the Olympics.
She's taking them HGHs.
No, it's literally she's just naturally fast, and I guess they're saying like her because of your testosterone, you can't enter in the.
That's bullshit.
On Facebook, they tried to call that Shikari woman a man, just because she don't like women. She don't like niggas.
They
trying to call her a man.
But she said she don't like men.
Like some dude came up a whole thing about how she a man. She said like he misinformed. She said only record breakers in women's sports are trans. Like she didn't even break a record. She was kind of ass until now. But
it's no, she was like, decent. Niggas talk too.
Like Olympic sports is almost like this is about to be some bad takes, bro. Just get it. The motherfucker's about to be bad, bro.
Yeah. I ain't even go. But that's what I heard. So clown to whatever that is. Because, like, come on now, dog. Let these women out here be great.
Yeah, exactly. Let them cook, G.
But. And my goat is Falcon. So y'all niggas know that I'm a huge Legend of Hero, Trails of Cold Steel fan. I fucking love that series. Well, I think it was like Friday or Thursday, but they had like this concert for like one of their anniversaries and they dropped like a whole bunch of like games because there's a lot of games that are only in Japan right now. And they dropped announcements that they're all coming over to the West. So we got like the Crossbell Saga. So there's two games in there. There's another game that was only exclusively in Japan called like Legend of Naruto, I believe, that's coming to the West. And then the sequel to Trails of Cold Steel 4, which is what I beat, I think, this year, last year, is coming. The only thing that sucks is they announced it, and, like, most of those games are coming out in 2023. was like, what the fuck? Like, thank you for... It's like, I was happy when I saw the announcement trailer, but then when I saw the date, I was like, well, fuck. It's 2023. Like, thank you so much for building my hype, my hype up for nothing. But I'm very happy that this series is continuing to go strong. It's a very niche series. But I'm just when I saw that, because I literally woke up and that was the first thing I saw on my YouTube feeds. And I was like, let's fucking go. Oh, speaking of niche series, This Guy of Six comes out on Tuesday. And I love fucking This Guy. So I will say, expect the Black Otaku plays of that as well. Maybe.
That's the Switch exclusive, right?
That's the Switch exclusive. But it's like, it's one of those, because I'm very hyped for that game, and I don't want it to be, I don't want to be forced to record that game to play.
Don't do it then.
So it's like, it's one of those things where it's like, I really want to see people play it, but at the same time, I want to just play it whenever I want to play it and not force myself to record.
Yeah, don't do that then. Just enjoy your own experience then, bro, when it comes to that. Like, don't force it, so.
Especially out of the way you're supposed to play RPG, I mean, JRPGs, in which you don't want to go this way, you kind of want to go like that and shit.
Don't force that one. So yeah, like, you know. Now if you do, just record gameplay and just throw commentary randomly. But I like if that. Now don't force yourself. But it's going to wrap this episode up. Thanks for listening. As always, make sure you follow us on Twitter at The Black Otakus. Watching us on YouTube, you know, comment, like, subscribe. Check out all the content on the YouTube Media YouTube page. And if you're listening to us, whether SoundCloud, Spotify, or Apple Podcasts, make sure you hit that subscribe button, follow button, whatever, like, and share. Above all, share, let your homies know, your cousin, brother, little sister, whatever, mama, daddy, if they rock with us, if you rock with us, let them rock with us as well. Just share the love. But thanks for listening, and peace.
Got it.